Don't take Matt not being here as the fact that, don't be offended by that.
I'm not.
That's almost like makes the show better that he shows up late.
Right. Perfect.
Do you see all these pages right here?
Mm-hmm.
These are all my notes.
Oh, man.
You have really spilled your heart out on your Instagram.
Yeah. It's, I think, it's been part of my recovery process from addiction. So it's like, the more truth that I speak, the better I feel. And the better I feel, then the more people I can help.
I say stuff on the show, and then I go back and listen to it, and I'm like, holy shit, did I really say that? Do you ever do that? or I give myself a little anxiety at night that, holy shit, I can't believe I shared that.
Yeah. I used to a lot, like when I first came out. There's some more stuff that'll come out during this podcast, like when I speak about the beginning of my recovery and stuff. But it's,
yeah, because it's Instagram, it's very surface.
Right.
I mean, you open up some huge doors.
Yeah.
That clearly you don't mind talking about,
Not at all.
But you don't get into the details in there. But
no.
But you like point at some big ones.
Yeah, and I think part of what has developed me as a husband, as a father, as in my faith, like the more that I put out there, the more understanding I can get. Saying it's like, oh, I do have these problems, because I'm very good about speaking about it. But it's like, oh yeah, I do have these problems, and I do still have these problems. So if I'm able to identify them and speak about them, then I can fix them. Then
How old are you?
Just almost 35.
And
I'm a master's competitor.
Are you still married?
I am. My wife, I always say that I was given a second chance, except for with my wife, and she gave me 9 years of chances.
Yeah.
And that was during my addiction. And we got married at 22.
I wrote in here, she dumped him.
Yeah,
because I thought she did, because I'm going through her Instagram, and then finally I saw some pictures of her, and I'm like, oh shit, she didn't dump me.
She's not as open as I am.
How did she not dump you?
She's a strong lady. And I've asked her, I mean, I asked her all the time, like, how did you not just get rid of me? And she was like, I was just hoping that someday that you would realize who you were again. And I was going to stick around, and I've asked her before, like, would you have stuck around, you know, if after my overdose, if I continued down that same path? And she's like, I can't say. I don't know. I mean, she did it for 9 years.
Right.
So
her parents and the pressure she must have felt from her friends and shit. I mean, people must have been telling her, hey, man, get away from this guy. Get your boys and leave.
I think it was.
Right. I mean, wouldn't you?
Oh, I would have bailed.
Imagine if she was easy doing that, and you had to be like, protect your boys. Right.
Oh, I'd be gone.
From someone who's.
Yeah. She was.
Were you violent at all?
Never.
Okay. Well, that's good.
And as violent as I never put my hands on her.
Right.
Now, there was an instance where I got a gun out, and I threatened, like, I'm going to kill myself right here, right now. And it was like, then I was broken still at that point, and then it was like, holy crap. And I was working at the time, and the next day I went in and quit my job and sold my guns. And I knew, like, okay, that was bad. Like, I can't do this. And so I think I went about 72 hours till I went back on the addict train. 72 hours about the...
So you scared yourself so much that you actually got yourself sober for 72 hours?
Yeah. And that was
awesome.
That was the... at that time, that was a huge deal. It was like, you can do this. You can be a normal drinker and you can have drinks. And we never talked about it. Like, she just was like, okay, like, here it is. But the mental abuse, physically, no. Mental, which in my eyes, it's just as bad. You know, it was.
I'm gonna be honest with you. When I hear your story, I wondered. There's two things I wonder before I meet someone like you, and I'm just meeting you 10 minutes ago.
Right.
I think holy shit, is this guy? How self-centered is this guy going to be? Because so much of his life has to be about him. Because you're, let me use a metaphor here. You're kind of like a man in a room with a cobra.
Right.
You cannot take your eyes off that snake. Because if you do, he's going to bite you. And you live like your life like that, I'm assuming. You have to be guarding your, and the cobra being a metaphor for your own thoughts and actions.
Yep. Every,
because you can't reach for any bottle
right.
or do things. And yet you, when I see, and so there's something built in self-centered about that, right? A certain like hyper level of self-awareness. And yet you are so giving. And I was kind of like tripping. I wonder what this guy's going to be like.
It's so every minute of every day, everybody's like, how do you deal with it? It's like every minute of every day I have.
Nice of you to show up, Matt.
Thank you.
Hey, good morning. I'm Troy Peterson. I'm here for the podcast.
Thank you.
But it's like every minute of every day, it's like head on a swivel. They teach you that in the military, like head on a swivel. And it's like if I lose concentration, I'll be back on the bottle. I'll be back in the pills. My anger has to stay down. That's why I'm glad you brought this out. I just figured that out. Like, that was smart. Like,
Matt, I push all my anger towards Matt. He's my scapegoat. Right. So if you have anything,
verify that.
If you have anything negative to say, just dump it that way. That's why he shows up late on purpose, just to kind of let me know that he's a dirtbag and he's there.
I thought that was like he was in charge. I thought that's what he's trying to tell you.
Oh, don't piss me off.
I am the boss.
Total alpha move.
I am the boss. I'm in control.
Are we ready? Are we recording yet, Eric?
No.
Just starting now that you got here.
How short is this cord?
Okay, head on a swivel. Have to be paying attention.
Yeah, like at all times, I have to realize what situation I'm in, what I can do and what I can't do, what I'm in control of. A lot of the things, like my faith. Like, I believe in God. I believe in Christ, but it's like I'm still an addict, so it's hard for me to put the two together because not hard for me. Sometimes I forget that I am a believer in Christ, and it's like because I get back on that addiction train and be like, how good would a Bloody Mary and a pack of Marlboros be right now?
You smoke cigarettes too?
Oh, yeah. When I drank, great. I smoked. Like, it was...
Did you ever smoke cloves? Dijon?
Yeah. Like in the Army... at Fort Hood, where I was at in Texas, cloves were a big thing. They always stunk, but it was like you smoked from Newports, you know, to Marlboros. You smoked everything but pot because pot's illegal. It was illegal in the Army, so that was a no-no. But it was one of those things where I had to become very self-aware of every situation that I put myself in. Like being in Vegas was funny. I've been to Vegas, I think, 5 times, and not one of them was ever sober. And not high. So walking into the Vegas airport was like, and then my wife and I talked about it, and she was like, are you going to be okay? And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm past that point. Like, I know who I am. Like, I know who the hell
When's
I am.
When's the last time you had a drink?
July 30th of 2015.
Okay.
The same night.
So we're approaching 3 years.
Yeah.
February 4th was two and a half year anniversary,
yes.
According to your Instagram.
Yep. Yep. And it was, and it's something that, like, those anniversary dates.
AA?
No.
Okay.
Well. It was CrossFit, and
don't let the cat out of the bag. You've gotten way too much from CrossFit.
Yeah.
You've gotten way
too much
from CrossFit.
I get it.
It's crazy how
what
much you've
it
taken.
Can do.
And now you're giving back.
Yeah.
It's pretty badass.
People deserve the opportunities that I've been given and the work that I have also put in to put myself around good people because of CrossFit. Like, everybody deserves that chance.
Someone DM'd me the other day and they said, hey, I'm really frustrated with my affiliate owner. He did this, this, and this, and this, and this, and what do you think I should do? And I said, you should do the same thing that everyone does who has a problem. 100 fucking burpees.
Yeah.
And the answer will come to you right when you're done.
Yeah.
And he wrote back. He's like, thanks, I did it. That worked. I know exactly what I'm going to do. And I didn't even ask him what. I was like, yeah, that's what I do.
If
I have a problem in my head, I need to breathe. And I need some intensity to get out of my head. That's a term you use that I love.
If you
100 burpees will do that.
Are putting in enough effort, which my effort is someone like a Daniel Tominski, who we'll get into, or Elijah Muhammad, or my affiliate owner, Reggie, my friend Ryan, my coach, is like, my effort is different than theirs. But during 18.1, while I'm a lot slower than them, I'm not thinking about anything but 18.1. Or 18.2 or any workout that I do, if I'm putting in that effort, if I'm doing CrossFit correctly, that time is me time.
Eric Maciel running the cameras, microphone, and overall in charge. Matt Bischel, head of CrossFit Games. No, what do you do? You're head of CrossFit social media?
Alpha
male today.
The boss.
Self-proclaimed
Could you call
alpha
me boss?
Troy Peterson, hardcore CrossFit enthusiast. CrossFit saved his life. For some of us, it gave us a second chance, or brought us new life, or got us laid, or whatever. But for this guy, it literally saved his life, saved his marriage. Best thing that ever happened for his kids. Some crazy, crazy subjects to talk about hardcore drug addiction, suicide. Something that maybe a lot of people can't relate to, but a lot of people can relate to this third topic, which is even more insane that it's matched up with these other two, is 100-pound weight loss. And he's made it his goal to share these stories so that other people feel comfortable sharing these stories, because by sharing them, he has found reprieve.
Peace.
Peace.
Personal inner peace.
I know, you know, we had a lady in here who is bulimic. I don't know shit about bulimia. We had a hockey player in here. I don't know shit about hockey. And your topics, like hardcore drug addiction and suicide and 100-pound weight loss, I don't know shit about that either. So it's like...
But I think that...
It's awesome that you would come in here and, like, educate us.
And I think like this podcast, it's you guys won't give yourself credit, but the topics you speak on can affect so many people. And if people can hear it and relate, like, so much positivity can be spread. We can all focus on the negative things, or we can take the positivity and shove it down people's throats. And it's not my life isn't all unicorns and roses and rainbows and it's all beautiful. Like, it's a lot of work. And I think to be successful, you have to put in a lot of work. And if being successful to me is being a father of two and a husband, cool. And a mediocre at best CrossFitter, fucking awesome.
Well, mediocre at best is relative, right?
Yeah. And for me, I'm fantastic. Like, in my own eyes, like, I love it. This is great. I need to improve. I'll be back tomorrow. Like, this sucked. See you in the morning.
You're 35 years old. Where were you born?
I was born in Des Moines, born and raised in a suburb just outside of Des Moines called Johnston.
That's Iowa?
Yes.
That's in the middle of the country, much equidistant from San Francisco and New York for anyone.
Yes.
I mean, I don't know if that's true, but for
anyone. Right in the middle.
It's good enough.
Interstate 35 runs north and south. I-80 runs east and west. They meet in Des Moines.
That's for our 6 international listeners. Right. I didn't know.
If you're looking at a map right now, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
You're born, how many siblings?
I have one older brother, a younger half-brother, and 2 stepbrothers and 2 stepsisters, but we all, not together as a family, but we're considered 2 separate families.
Okay. And so you were born to a mom and a dad, husband and wife,
yeah,
married at the time.
They
got a divorce.
Yep, they got a divorce just after I turned 3, and both were remarried shortly after. My dad and my stepmom had known each other for years, my mom and stepdad. They kind of all ran in the same group, I guess, if you want to say. My dad and stepmom went to high school together. My dad and stepdad had played softball together before, you know, kids and stuff, so they all... knew of each other at least. And
are you still in that town?
I moved just south, like an hour south of where I grew up.
But still Iowa.
Yep. Went back.
You go to an elementary school, pretty uneventful regular life, elementary school, junior high, high school.
And this is like a lot of part I don't speak about, but I think the more you speak out truth, it was there were some things that went abroad during the elementary middle school years, and abroad by I mean some bad things happened. My parents, this is the first time they're really going to hear about this, so there was some SVU type stuff that had happened. Law and Order Special Victims Unit, like the that's how I relate it. Like, I talk to small groups about it. There was a couple year period that I went through some stuff as a kid that wasn't fair.
You mean adult sexually abuse you?
Not necessarily adult, just an older person that was older than me.
Gotcha. How much older?
Just a couple years. I think I was 8.
And so he I'm assuming he?
Yeah.
10? 12?
12, 13.
And how does that happen? Babysitter's house?
Yeah, kind of just... More of like not in my home, we lived like in the woods. So like some of the creepy thing, like where your mind just went in the woods, like
right.
Some of that, like a lot of violent threats, stuff you know as a kid you don't comprehend. So it's like, okay,
someone did that to him.
I had to have.
And then he's playing it out with you.
Right.
God damn.
It's a.
Are you is that like one of your number one concerns about your boys?
Yeah, and all kids. I volunteer with kids, and so it's there's a distance there. Like, I want to do as much as I can, and I can read a kid pretty well, and people, I believe, as well, because that's just kind of my thing is personal relationships, and it's like, that's my fear.
Were you ever afraid you would do that to other people?
No. It was always one of those things where, like, you put it completely in the back of your mind, like it's gone. You know what I mean? Like it was gone, it happened, it's over, it's done. Something that, like, thankfully there was no social media. You know what I mean? To, like, dig into personally, like, it was just like, damn, that sucks.
That's actually a really good question, though. It's like, if there is a cycle that's going, you know, how do you stop that? Or I think I would be afraid or even think of, like, you know, maybe it's going to continue.
Yeah. For me, it was the cycle, like, that, and I call it a vicious cycle. Like, there had to come a point in time where I had to that decision, like, which road are you going to take? Are you going to be a victim? Or are you going to be a leader? And I eventually chose to be the victim, I mean, with my overdose.
Do you think that there's a connection between that incident as a kid and eating and putting on too much weight and the drug addiction?
I do. I think it all of it came, everything came into one sitting. I think that was a part of the problem.
Is it as simple as when those thoughts arise about that incident, you then, instead of dealing with those thoughts, you eat something?
Absolutely.
That's that simple.
Absolutely.
That's how the mechanism works, you think?
And I
are you sure of that in yourself? Like, you,
for me, yes.
You watch that, like, absolutely. In a meditative state, you've seen that? Oh, shit, I'm eating to bear.
Absolutely, because I still sometimes do it. I joke a lot about peanut butter, like, oh, man, peanut butter.
I've seen it. Delicious.
And it's crazy. Like, if you don't have peanut butter in your life, like, you're missing out.
Are you a creamy or a chunky guy?
Creamy. Like, Jif, natural peanut.
You can add peanut butter to anything, and it makes it better.
So I've
anything.
Like in Iowa, we have fried pork tenderloins, which are very healthy for you, obviously, like fried food. But if you put peanut butter on that bad daddy, it just turns into really good.
A friend of mine told me one time that if there's anything that a man does sexually that surprises you, then you don't understand men at all.
Yeah.
And that kind of, like, that hit me. And I think that that's, like, a thing that a lot of people don't understand, that the male sex drive is, like, it's nuts.
It's
completely fucking maniacal and fucking out of control.
And there's nothing that you can't figure it out.
Right.
You can attempt all you want to figure it out sexually, like what a person thinks, the sexual thought. You're never going to figure that out.
It's like this. I have an all soap that you put in your laundry detergent. So I have one of those, like, sitting on a table in my laundry room. And we never use it. We don't use the all. But then there'll be it's like seeping through the plastic. Like, I lift it up and there's, like, a mark there.
Yeah.
So I wipe it up. I wipe it up and I put it back. And a month later, there's another mark there. And I'm like, how the fuck does this stuff get out of the plastic container? We never use it. That's how I feel like the male sex drive is. It just finds a way to seep into every, like, fucking corner and pore. And it's like, Jesus.
You can make you can relate everything. And I'm not the most inappropriate, like, even the people, like, my close friends, like, know that there's an inappropriate comment coming, like, just wait, just, like, I can relate everything,
the porn opponent,
but everything you can make
that
a porn
component, yes. The porn opponent.
That's absolutely true. Yeah. You can relate it back to anything.
And so unfortunately you were on the tail end of a horrible expression. First of all, like, no kid should have to go through that shit.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then so that what's the first thing that you do you have friends growing up?
Yeah, I have a lot of friends. Like, my neighborhood was, like, the way kids should grow up, like, riding bikes to each other's house, playing outside from sun up to sundown.
Not in the forest.
You do not go near the forest.
Stay out
what
the woods.
What should have happened? There should have been another kid there. What could you in hindsight have done?
If I think about it, like, now it's easy for me to say, because I know what I should have done. I should have told my parents.
Right.
Immediately.
Right.
Like, this isn't a complaint. This isn't a whine. This isn't a gripe.
Right.
This sucks.
Right.
Like, this is terrible. And my parent, it would have stopped. No doubt in my mind.
I should go home and tell my son, hey, if anyone ever does anything bad to you, you come tell me. And
absolutely.
I will make it better. I'm here to protect you.
That trust factor that I had with my parents was always there. Always there, that
both
connection.
Both mom and dad?
Yeah, absolutely. Now, they didn't have it, but it would have worked. But I didn't want to hurt my parents. I didn't want to, like, worry my parents.
Right.
And so that was my thought process is,
At eight,
I don't want to put that on them.
Yeah, at eight, you were already that thoughtful.
Yeah, like, it just, it, it, the kindness of, man, I don't want to bother my parents with this. They, you know, they got work. They got to raise other kids. Like, I don't want to be the problem child.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So it's...
Were there other kids?
We never talked about it.
Right.
You know, it was never discussed. Do we... Like, I still talk to those guys now, so I don't think so. I don't think it's... I've talked to them about it, and it's
never
come up.
You have the same friends from when you were a kid?
I talk to them. Mm-hmm. A couple of them live in other states. One of my sons, Tucker, is named after my friends growing up. So we text a lot. We used to party a lot together. Now I don't party. Cool. And not necessarily that they have continued that party streak, but it's just we're at different places in our life. Like, I don't like to leave my boys, you know?
I get that.
It's.
I almost didn't make this podcast.
My wife and I looked at plane tickets, and I was like, "Holy cow! Like, this is we wanted to bring them out here." And so, like, going to the airport yesterday, I was all excited. And then I get to the hotel room, I'm like, "I want to FaceTime my kids." So we FaceTimed like 4 times last night in like
awesome.
A 2-hour period, you know.
Love it.
And then I FaceTimed it before school this morning, and my 2-year-old. With my wife, and it's my friends are we're still friends, and I know. I can always count on them. We were so close, and I wasn't able to control my addictions by placing myself in the middle of that group.
You start eating. When do you start getting? This happens to you at 8. When do you start putting on weight?
About.
Were your parents obese?
I wouldn't. Yeah. They're bigger people. You know, like health wasn't a big. Concern of theirs. A lot of home cooking, you know what I mean? A lot of big family meals. It's becoming more important now that I'm speaking out about it, and I don't think it's just me. It's the realization of, damn, I got to take care of myself more. But it was, I would say, it stopped when I was like 13. So between like 11 and 13, I started to do, I was a big kid.
What stopped when you were 13?
I stood up for myself when I was like 13. So this it went on for
holy
it wasn't,
shit,
yeah,
for 5 years.
Yeah. Wow. And it was there was a lot of violence, a lot of threats of like, if you do this, this is what I will do to you, this is what I will do to others. And it was like, I don't know any different.
And by now he's 16, 17.
Pretty close, yeah.
Yeah, he's like driving age.
Right.
Holy shit.
Yeah. It's so
I'm sorry.
Oh, well, I appreciate that, and that's why
that,
it's
I'm
important
sorry that anyone has to go through that
for me to speak about this, whether it happened way, way, way in the past. Like, there's other people this has happened to. You holding it on is not going to do anything. It's not helping anybody. It's only hurting you. You're not saving anybody's ass, and that shouldn't be your goal. The self-love and self-empowerment, the way you get that and start to achieve that is by speaking out about it. And whether you take the path that I have to where I'll talk about this stuff all day long with anybody that wants to listen to it. And usually I do talk about it all day long.
Does it freak people out? Do you ever bring up your stories and people are like, oh shit, I'm not comfortable with suicide?
Nobody's ever said anything negative to my face about any of this.
Not negative, but I mean like you can just tell.
Not
they get sideways.
Not one time have I felt that somebody was uncomfortable in this situation. Whether it was speaking out to kids at my church with other adults, or speaking to like just one-on-one with my wife or one-on-one with my friends.
I wonder if people hear stuff like this, conversations like this, and they're involved in a practice of this predatory practice.
Right.
Is that fair?
Yeah, that's what I'd call it. You're a predator, yeah.
And they stop.
I hope.
Or at least they think, holy shit.
And that's that.
You know what I mean? Like they're so caught up in it. I know this is going to sound insane to some people, but they're so caught up in it that they don't even realize that they're being a predator. And then they hear someone like you and they're, oh, holy fuck, I'm hurting someone's
absolutely
life.
Like I'm really, I don't want to say I'm on the fence with this. This is a lot of like self thought I've had. Like I'm not on the fence. I'm removing your damn fence and I'm going to build a new one. And this is what's going to happen. So speaking out about it, talking about it, like some people are sick. And those people can't always help it. Just like people with negative attitudes. Like, you can help a negative thought process of, like, the bitching and the whining and complaining. Like, shut up. Like, I got it. Like, I have to – I shouldn't say shut up because I have to, like, be patient because a lot of people are patient with me. But it's like with someone who's a predator, I don't think they can always help it. It doesn't give them an excuse at all.
Right. And I don't hear you making one for them. Hmm. It's interesting because you were in a situation where there was a guy who's obviously damaged and you were part of his addiction or part of the manifestation of his troubles. But you specifically didn't pass that down.
Right.
You instead took the stuff you did, you took responsibility for overeating, over drinking.
Took ownership.
Yeah. Popping the pills.
Right.
And then eventually that led to sobriety.
Absolutely.
Why did you join the military?
I was kind of, I was at a crossroads of like, I'd entered community college, and the previous summer, after I graduated in the spring of 2001, I liked to party. So I was like, well, some of my buddies are still here. I'll just do community college and figure out what I'm going to do, you know? So I did community college, and my buddy and I had been talking about with a recruiter and what we could do, and then September 11th happened, and I was like, here it is. It's right there in front of me.
You weren't too fat to be
good? No, I had I was a healthy husky, if that makes any sense. Like, I've always, like, what I am now is about what I was in high school.
Okay.
Like 220 pounds, just over 6 foot. Like, I played sports. I was active in sports, but I was always, like, I had a sweet pair of love handles. You know what I mean? Like, that's my body type. Like,
were you comfortable with your body in high school?
Like, I always,
you take your shirt off at the river.
I take my shirt off anywhere. Like, I'm probably gonna take it off before the end of this podcast. Like, if I could go,
well, wouldn't be the first in here.
No, if I could go anywhere with my shirt off, I would go everywhere with it.
Okay,
like, I just, and it's
even then you didn't give a fuck.
You just didn't chilling. Care.
Okay, cool.
Didn't care.
I love it.
Did not care. 335 pounds, like broken out in boils. You know, because I sweat so much.
Shit. And, wow, are you a hairless man?
I'm by personal choice.
Oh, okay.
By personal choice.
Oh, and how do you do that with, like, Nair or
no way. I've never. I had one experience with Nair in the military, and I think now they make a Nair for your genitals. And back then they didn't. And so, like,
it's good to know.
Reading directions is hard for me. So it was like,
so you burned your nuts.
Oh man. Right before we went to actually the National Training Center out here at Fort Irwin, I was like, I got 45 days or I think it was 40 days. I got to be hairless because no one's going to be there to shave my back. No one's going to be there to.
Oh my goodness.
I'm not going to be trimming my junk out in the sand.
So you're finishing high school. 9/11 happens.
Yep.
You feel this patriotic surge come over.
I was mad.
You're mad. What do your parents say when you join?
My mom was not having it. She cried a lot. My stepbrother was a Marine recon, like a Billy Badass, ghillie suit, the whole, you know, I mean, real badass. So I didn't want to take that route. So I was, I joined the Army. I wanted to be badass, but not that badass. So I got mad and I said, well, I can put this to good use. Like, I'm a number. Everybody said, well, you'll just be a number and you'll be a casualty. I'm like, okay, well, if I go down fighting for my country, then if that's the worst thing, like, that will make up for what happened to me as a kid. Because I took ownership as a kid that it was my fault. So being abused was my fault. I did this. Somehow I put myself in this situation.
Is that normal? Is that the way it goes? Is that, like, kind of the protocol for victims?
I think it's an easy spiral for children to fall down.
Yeah, it's easier to take the blame to, like, my two-year-old, like, he does something and it's, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, and it's like, it breaks your heart. And my wife are like, no, 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 like, he doesn't get it because he's two. And he's like, sorry, sorry. He'll fall down and say sorry. And so I think it's just kind of human nature that it's, and I don't know necessarily human nature, but, like, having to take something away so somebody else doesn't get in trouble or somebody else doesn't get blamed, it's easy. So always up for a selfie. That's Lunchbox. He raids the pantry all day. That's his job. And that's Mouth. He just talks all day. It's Tucker and Truitt.
And you call him that on your Instagram,
right? Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So you sign up for the Army. You did boot camp.
I signed up the day after September 11th, I signed the contract and I did.
Wow, was there a line in the recruiting office?
Hell no.
Okay.
No. Okay. There was in Iowa, there wasn't, like, it was in the basement of the mall.
Okay.
And I met the recruiter there, my buddy and I did. We met him there and I remember we both signed and I did what was called the delayed entry program, and which just gives you some time to get into better shape. because I wasn't making the tape test, which they tape around your waist. They do the body fat test. Well, I wasn't making it.
What was your BMI? What was your weight?
I think I was like 21. And I had a big neck, so it was always close. Like, you're like right at the line, buddy. And so, like, I did a delayed injury program, and I worked out at the National Guard base. Yeah, that was, I think.
Wow, look how young you look.
Yeah, and holy, I had, shit. I was so dumb, I put peroxide in my hair. That did not go over well in the Army.
No.
No. Oh, yeah, my section chief did not approve of this. And he let me know real fast that I'm not stupid.
Okay.
Yeah, this is not good for you. Like, that was before I went to Iraq.
Couldn't you just shave it off?
I could have, but he just let me have some embarrassment.
Oh, nice.
You know, like, it went away pretty fast. Like, I think back then I used to cut my hair like every 5 days.
Okay.
Get a haircut every 5 days, that short. So, yeah, I joined the Army. And
so what did you do to get in shape? What did you do?
Just a lot of running. A lot of running, push-ups and sit-ups, because that's the PT test. The physical fitness test was just running, just push-ups and just sit-ups. And that's – so I did a lot of that. And I was an average runner. So I just had to continuously run all the time and continuously do push-ups. And so I left for basic right after the first of the year. And I actually...
January of 2012.
Right. And I actually was so drunk the night before I left that I got sick. I got the brown bottle flu. And so, and when I went in there, I failed the tape test.
I've never heard that. Wait, brown bottle
two things.
Flu.
2002, you mean? Yeah, and what's brown bottle flu?
Oh, yeah, 2002.
The brown bottle flu is when you drink so much you get sick.
I gotta run this show.
Like, people are like, oh, I think I got a stomach bug. I'm like, no, dude, you had like 12 beers and 6 shots. Like, you have a brown bottle flu.
So how old were you when you had your first drink?
Oh.
Did your parents let you drink at home?
No. No, that was never.
Did you drink every day in high school?
No, it was probably half.
So you had alcohol in your locker and shit like that?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Like, every, like, Mountain Dew with vodka in it. You know, like, you
at
could
school.
Go. In, like, in my car.
I don't approve of the Mountain Dew, by the way, but other than that.
Yeah. Like, it was, like.
I kept Goldschlager in my locker.
A lot of times.
Goldschlager? How random is that?
Is that the only liquor they sold at the time?
Like, when you're a kid, you can get whatever your hands on.
Or Jaeger. I kept that in my
locker. Yeah. I used to get down. I hated it. And I used to.
Get down with it?
Oh, yeah. I used to. Put a lot of that in my body, but it's
so you were drinking in high school?
Yeah. And okay. It was
with my friends,
like,
but you never had any episodes where, like, you vomited at school? Like,
not in school, but everywhere. I would get so drunk I would vomit everywhere, like almost every time I drank.
You were one of those guys?
Oh yeah. Okay. Like, the few times I would go to the University of Iowa, Iowa City, like, I'd be puking in alleys. You know, like, when we went my senior year, we went to Panama
City. Did bad shit ever happen to you? Like, you ended up in jail or getting fights
Never.
Or get your teeth kicked in or nothing?
Never.
Yeah, okay. Well, if you don't have one of those happen, it's
I was on the other end of it.
Yeah.
To where, like I've always had a support system. I've always had people, like, who truly have loved me. So, like, when things got bad, they would help me. You know, and
all right,
like,
get Troy to the car.
Exactly. Right,
who's gonna go to the bathroom with Troy and let him,
like,
puke and
yep,
then put him in the car?
Always.
We'll come back and get him.
Always. There was always
someone giving you a pillow and a blanket.
Always.
Okay.
Yeah. Tucking me in at night, like, whatever it was. It was the trash can by my face, making sure, like, that I was on my stomach with my head tilted to the side. So if I threw up, you know, in the middle of the night, I wouldn't choke on it. And it was, I always had somebody babysitting me.
And it wasn't until you bleached your hair you finally had someone to tell you.
Yeah, like, really. Like, I wasn't, like, I didn't listen to my parents. So it was like, my parents were like, you cannot drink and drive. So I didn't drink and drive. Like, I didn't have sex till I was out of high school. Like, I just graduated. And because my mom was like, if you get someone pregnant, you're out. And I believed her. I was like, okay. Like, I believe this, but it was,
I'm
like,
going to use that.
And a lot of people have, like, I truly believed, like, what my mom said. Like, she was like, if you get someone pregnant, you're moving out of this house. And I knew that, like, my dad, I was like, man, if I have to explain to my dad that I got somebody pregnant, like.
I was so afraid I was going to get AIDS that, like, I just thought that if you looked at a girl,
like,
too long.
My stepmom gave me the not to make light of it, the Ryan White book, and I took that to heart.
Well, is that
a It was a, like AIDS a, story? A kid back in the 80s, like the first person that ever came out to speak about AIDS, and I took that to heart, and I'm like, I remember that book and being like, okay, I got to be careful. Like, this is the real.
Yeah.
So really being careful. I don't want to raise someone and then not do a good job at it.
Did you ever, as a young boy, find a condom and put a condom on?
Never.
Never did that?
I don't think I've ever worn a condom.
Really?
My wife's allergic to latex.
Wow. I remember being a young boy, very young, like probably sixth or seventh grade, and getting a condom, I think probably from my dad's drawer or something, and putting it on, thinking like just in case I had sex that day. it must have fallen off in the bottom of my underwear like 300 times that day, and then I'm like, all right, I'm not.
See, oh,
that was my condom
like
experience.
You wore it out and about?
Oh, yeah, like I put it on in the morning. I got it at night, and then in the morning, I'm like, I come put this on and wear it today.
I made up for it on other ends. I've always been a giving person, so like with the girls, I was always a very giving person. Like it was never like about like penetration with my penis. It was always the other, like, oral. Like, here you go. Like, watch this. So that was always my scapegoat.
You're a very generous man.
Very kind. Very kind. Always giving.
I wonder if that's tied into...
Ooh. It's all going to come back full circle. It does.
Always to that moment.
It has to.
Yeah, it's amazing.
It has to. And that's something that... my wife and I've had a lot of heart to heart about is like why I am that way. And not just with like
sex
in other ways. Like sometimes, I forget to take care of myself that I want to, like, I don't want to save the world. I want to save my community and see where it goes. I want other people to save their communities, but it's like, sometimes I get my head so wrapped up in that, like I forget to take care of myself.
How many days a week are you CrossFitting?
At least four. I try to give myself a couple day break. Like,
are you addicted to it?
Yeah. Like, I'm addicted to like the mantra, where you the
could,
whole thing.
To the point where you could injure yourself? Like,
no.
You overtrain?
No.
No. Okay.
No, luckily, there's another veteran. Like, my affiliate owner preaches that, like, don't hurt yourself. And so does like the head coach is like, sometimes there's too much. And one thing that really impacted me is Chris Beeler was at our gym.
Who?
Chris Beeler, his sister.
Don't know him.
Never heard of him. He's kind of fit.
Not familiar.
But his sister and brother-in-law go to our gym. Clay Weldon. He we'll hopefully get to talk.
He lives
about
in
him.
Iowa now.
Yeah, they moved. They have a daughter on the up and up in the gymnastics world.
Okay, wow.
She's fantastic. So they've relocated to the Des Moines area.
And what's the name of your affiliate?
CrossFit Waukee.
Okay. I hope she escaped Dr. Whatever the fuck. That
yeah, I that I I don't I don't think th- I think she's nine, so I don't think
that
she
must
had...
have fucking hit you like a fucking.
Oh,
ton
it made
of bricks.
Me so mad.
What's that fucking idiot's name? Dr. Lamar.
I reached out to her right away, and said like, this is like, cause my community knows what happened.
You know, at least one of those girls killed themselves.
Yeah,
I was watching one of the moms testify, and she said my daughter
you're
can't
the reason.
Be here, and I'm like, oh. Fuck.
Yeah, it was hard for me to watch it, and so I would record it and go back when, because I would get so mad and I get so frustrated, and I'd have to go back and watch the recorded court proceedings.
Did
later.
You see the dad?
Yeah, I was all about it. My wife and I talked about that, and like they wouldn't have stopped me. That guy was slow.
I don't mean to take a shot at that guy either, but
he moved a little too slow.
Yeah, he should.
Like there was no. There's certain things that I.
He should have kept like a wooden dowel in his pants or something that he could stick in and fucking.
I would
have
karate
lunge
chopped
over, you
that dude.
Crack
him. He did not possess breakaway speed.
No. And that
crackhead speed was not in that guy's pocket.
And that's one of those things where
but
watching
still impressive
like,
that he
I'm
did
like,
it.
Oh, that's amazing! Yeah. Like I get goosebumps just thinking about stuff like that. Like,
I loved it how one of the cops, as they took him away, was patting him on the back.
Yeah, like it's okay.
Or like good.
He was brought back in later. Like we get it, dude. Like I got it, and that's. What people say they would or wouldn't do, like, I know what I would do.
Right.
I know exactly what I would do. And you can't speak on a lot of things like military stuff. It's like, well, if somebody broke into my house or if I saw this happening, I would do this. And it's like, I've done those things. I've taken a human life.
There's only one thing weirder. There's only one thing more probably stronger than the male sex drive. It's probably like a mom's desire to protect her children. And you're right. Like if you threaten them, if you threaten someone's kids and they accidentally kill you, like there's boundaries. There's
my wife
things.
Is a very patient, like even keeled, can handle her stuff. But when it comes to something with my kids, there's a switch that turns.
I was shooting this documentary in Kenya, and I was out in the middle of fucking nowhere, and there was this pile of trees, like probably like 40 trees, and right in the middle of this footpath, and the locals told me, I go, what happened here? And they said, oh, a mama elephant and her baby were coming around the corner, and she saw someone, a human being. The mama elephant picked a human up, smashed it on the ground, and then the person was dead. and then pulled all the trees in the area and covered the threat.
Show you.
Yeah, yeah. Like, holy shit. Yeah.
Like, that's that child protection, I think.
Yeah, I'm not fucking with Haley.
Yeah, there you go.
Jesus.
It's when it comes to the protection of my kids, like, it's all business. Like, I love, like, if somebody, like, one time, a gentleman.
And the gratitude. Someone you could totally hate could do something really nice mm-hmm. to your kid, and you're like, hey, I actually kind of like you.
Yeah, like, like, you're cool now. Like, you're yeah. cool now. But, like, somebody yeah. ran into my son.
It goes both ways.
Before, right?
It's weird.
Like, right after I got sober at a CrossFit thing, a guy ran into my kid.
Your wife's beautiful, by the way.
Yeah, yeah, she's not
your
terrible.
Your entire family's
yeah.
beautiful.
Yeah, we're models.
Okay, sorry.
There's no doubt about it.
So someone ran
into Tucker when he was like 4, and they're like, "Tell your kid to watch out." And it woke me up. Like, it was, you don't take my kindness as a weakness. Like, there's still, like, I still did some pretty badass things, so I know what I can do, and I had to reel myself in pretty quick because it was in a large public setting, and I was like, "Yeah, he'll watch out for you running into him." You're right.
Yeah.
You just ran into my 4-year-old, like, he'll watch out for you running him over. Like, thanks.
I've had weird things like that happen too, like at the beach when there's a lot of people, someone's like, "Hey, tell your kid to get out of the way." And it's like,
yeah, why?
And there's people everywhere, right? There's thousands yeah. of kids and people. You're like, so you go into the Army, and what's that like? So you do
so basic training for me, like,
do you keep drinking?
No, all substances stop. Like, the I wasn't big on the drugs at this point because, like, pot made me fall asleep. Like, I just was like, it knocked me out. And the drinking stopped, the cigarette smoking stopped, and I started to kind of get some relief through, like, physical training and, like, bettering myself. Like, I got down to, like, 175 pounds.
Wow.
And I was like, I was thin, like. The bones in my shoulders were sticking out, and it was like, man, this guy looks sick. But I felt great,
of course.
You know, at 18 years old, like, in right. the best shape of my life. You always hear people say, I was in the best shape of my life. Like, I was in the best shape of my life, and I felt great about myself, and everything was fantastic, and I started to become a part of something.
Gary Roberts, who works here, joined the Marine Corps. I want to say he's 6'2", and I want to say that through boot camp, he dropped below 180, 179.
Yeah, that sounds right.
And he said he felt incredible.
Yeah. Like, I felt absolutely amazing. I never, like, felt sick or anything. So, basic training was good for me. And we did basic training and advanced individual training at the same time. So, it was, like, 16, 17 weeks of continuous training at Fort Sill.
At any point were you like, holy shit, I've been sober for 4 months?
Or never.
Not
even a problem identified at that
okay,
point.
Okay.
Like, at that time, it was like, man, a beer kind of sounds good, but, like, being in shape sounds better, you know, but it's like, damn, I wish I could have, you know, like, I want to go have, at that time, I think it was like 6 to 7 beers a day, like, nothing.
Up to that point.
Right. Up to until I went to basic training. And then, like,
that was like a baseline day. That's like Monday.
Normal.
6 beers.
Absolutely. Yeah. Normal.
And Friday's 18.
Oh, yeah. Friday was, we would split, I think, between the 4 of us, maybe a case and a bottle of vodka.
What am I going to ask next, Matt?
About what we'd do on Fridays?
No,
God, fucker.
I was really listening. What kind of beer? What kind of beer?
It was
you should know my train of thought by now.
No, I feel like I can guess what kind of beer.
It was originally Bud Light to be cool, but then we were like Natty Light.
Nectar of the gods.
Yeah. I hear people say that.
So natty. And you can, you, I was so natty.
Like, I could, you could poke a hole in a natty light and just, like, water.
And then from there, as I became more sophisticated in, like, you know, baller status, I went to Coors Light.
Ew, no.
Watch out for you.
Those mountains will never be blue enough for I would never.
And my friends had switched to micro brews and
never
and all
was
that.
My thing.
Yeah.
Never could do that.
Yeah. I feel like Iowa would be in, like, Miller country, right?
Wisconsin. I don't think it. No, it's. Now Des Moines has kind of gotten fancy, so there's a lot of, like, IPA local brews.
Iowa got fancy. Tried to say that in here.
like Des Moines kind of is. In a transformation right now, so they're
switching from corn to hemp. Like, what?
Yeah, like, they like, just, it's not just Natty Light and Bud Light anymore. Like, there's some local brewery type things, and I just talked about this.
Is Brooke Wells from Iowa?
I wish. I mean,
sorry, I'm trying to find something good about this state.
Street Horner.
Okay.
Elijah Muhammad lives there now.
He's good, but he's not from there.
Street Horner, is it?
No, Elijah Muhammad.
No, but it doesn't matter. His driver's license is like, he's got to be in Iowa now.
All right, all right.
Street Horner, like the second best looking man in the world.
He's pretty good looking. How do you say you're Iowanian?
No, I'm from Iowa.
Iowa?
My wife's grandpa used to be like, you're an idiot out wandering around Iowa. And I'm like, I got it. Like,
there's these games athletes that people always want me to talk about, like Kim or Jacob Heppner, shit like that. And they're just not, they just don't.
It's mid
Street Horner, Jacob Heppner. They don't stick in my head. Like
Street Horner sounds like a movie star.
Yeah, he looks like a movie star.
But
he does what he's supposed to do. And this, as far as like the games, I'm 34 and I watch Street Horner. I watch like Reggie Hoig, my affiliate owner. He went to regionals in 2014. Or Bobby Noyce, who's been to regionals I think 6 times in the Central Regional.
I don't even know any of these guys.
You know Bobby Noyce?
Guy just puts in work, does what he's supposed to do, runs his business. He's a father. You know, like these guys are like dads first.
This picture looks like it's from the 70s.
Look at that.
Cops.
Look at that. Look how I make him look good.
You look more buff than him.
So this was for, the Justin Martin, a police officer in Des Moines that was killed in 2017. It's for a fundraiser for him.
Oh, yeah.
Or 2016, I'm sorry. Elijah just moved into town, and like being the new guy has to suck. So I reached out to him, and I slid into his DMs, and I'm like, hey, let's work out. And he was like, okay, here's my address. So we went.
Him and his family are amazing.
Cool.
Oh, my God.
They're
goodness.
Cool.
Incredible family.
And they, so we did squats off of his washer and dryer. We moved his washer and dryer out in the driveway and did squats off it. And I'm like, I'm doing squats with, like, one of the strongest, fittest people ever. Like,
how's he doing this year? Is he going to make it to regionals?
I hope so. He's right there on the line. I think this, like, 18.5 will make it or break it. Depends on who, I think, how they go to team. I don't know. It's pretty well stacked up. I'm sure Hopey does. You know, like, you want somebody like that to be out in front of, like, not only the sport, but for people to see, like, get to know.
His great role model.
His athleticism is fantastic.
Right.
Who he is as a human, he can snatch however much he wants, but I'd rather sit and have this conversation with him.
Good point. He when I met him, I think he was a basketball player at Tennessee Tech.
He still thinks he is.
Okay, good. And he was probably, that was 6-7 years ago, right? I met him. And I cannot believe what's happened to his body.
He is athletically gifted, and he is making the most out of it. If you want to see somebody maximizing their potential, Elijah Muhammad does it every single day.
Yeah, he's amazing.
And it's like he is.
How many kids does he have now?
4.
Wow.
Yep. And he is.
He deserves
it. He's a cool dad.
Yeah.
Yeah. They deserve him as, like, they, like, him deserving kids, but, like, they deserve every, like, a dad like that. Like, somebody who cares that much and, like, can give that much love. Like,
are you going to have more kids?
No. We tied the tubes. We didn't. I didn't, like, physically tie the tubes. That would have been cool. But, like, no, we just decided, like, okay, two healthy boys, we're okay. Like, we're okay with that. So,
oh, my God. That family,
look at that.
Is beautiful.
And that's all the time.
Incredible.
That's all. And this isn't like – and they have a daughter as well. But this isn't just like for social media. And that's what I love so much about him is like people are like, oh, my gosh, that guy's so strong and he moves so fast. And be like – I get goosebumps from watching him like be a father.
Yeah.
Like the things he says to his wife.
Matt gets like that around me.
I believe that. I believe that's why he was late. He was nervous to come in. He was jealous of us talking.
I had to prep myself.
And that's his dog Maverick, who has 3 legs. Champion. Doesn't make any excuses.
Matt and his wife have stopped using contraception since they met my kids and see my father and still
trying to pop out an Avi.
Dude, but those kids, your kids are cool. Like they're like, and I've talked to
I like you. Don't get
it. Like, it's like the stuff, like that's the reality of parenting. Like that's the reality of kids. Like there's no like, oh, look how nice my kid is. No, I've met your kid. Like your kid's not nice. Like you're not an involved parent. Like, come on. Like,
yeah, it speaks directly about you as a parent.
It's like you can put whatever you want on social media, but like I've seen you in public, dude.
It's amazing parents that don't. Anyway, I don't.
Yeah.
So. 4 months in, you're bottles down, working hard, lean and mean. You've never been back there.
No.
175. Okay.
And so I graduate from basic training in AIT in, I believe, June. And like that night, a couple of my friends come over and we have some beers with my mom. And she's not happy because she's like, I don't care if you serve your country or not. You're 18 years old. So right. She wasn't real happy with that. She was happy to see me, so she kind of let it slide. And then the party, and it just picked right back up.
And this is how many years into the military?
This was like 4 months.
4 months. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. So then, so I go back to the hometown after basic. You get like 2 weeks. I got 2 weeks to like go and talk to other kids, you know, about joining the army, and this is what it did for me. And then
was it cool? Is boot camp fun?
I'm a people person, so like it was never. I was putting in a lot of effort. Like I was definitely giving it my all. And I still had, like, the jokes in the side.
Be all you can be. That was the Army thing,
absolutely.
Right?
Like, yeah, Army Strong, I think it switched to. But it was, like, my drill sergeants. One of them would pull me in. He's like, what the hell is wrong with you? He's like, why are you always smiling? And it was just like, it could be worse. You know what I mean? This could, I've been in a worse situation. It could be a whole hell of a lot worse than where I'm at right now. So this is cool. I'm safe. You know, we're going back thinking about the things that happened as kids. Like, I'm safe. These people like me. They care about me. I'm part of a team.
You're excelling.
Yeah. Like, I'm fantastic. I was...
You're at the top of your class, probably.
I was the guide on bearer. So the person that walked out in front of formation. And then, like, when you go to the chow hall, you do, like, a stupid dance. And, like, dancing was my thing. So, like, coming up with, like, routines and doing that. Like, I was always, like, the... not necessarily the center of attention, but I... was like the captain, I guess you could say.
You were great for morale.
The the motivation, the morale. Mm. And that's kind of, I just, that portion helped me not think about the other things that had happened.
And how long were you in the Army?
I did just over 4 years.
So after 4 months, how long before you get deployed?
I got stationed, down at Fort Hood.
Where's
that? In between
what
Waco and
that?
Austin, Texas.
Okay.
It's in central Texas. And a couple months later, I met my wife. And she fell head over heels in love and asked me out on a date.
Where did you meet her? A bar?
So my aunt lived, in the north area of Austin, Georgetown, and her parents lived two doors down. So I'd actually had beers with her dad while she was at college when I first went down there. And he was like, man, I got to introduce you to my daughter. You're a great guy. She's great. Like, you would be great for each other. So we just... she came down and asked me out.
He knows how to pick them.
Oh,
huh?
Yeah.
She asked you out.
Oh, she can say whatever she wants. Like, I used to wash my car at my aunt's a lot, like, waiting for her to, like, come out. So I would say something. I'd never say a word. And then eventually she was like, she came down and she told me later, like, I had enough of you staring at me. Like, I just figured I'd give you a shot. And so I was kind of a rebound.
So girls
for her.
Know when we're doing that?
She did. I don't know. I don't know if they all do.
All right. I just assumed they had no fucking clue.
No, like,
what do you think, Matt? Do they know?
No,
yeah, okay, good. All right. Don't ruin that. Don't ever say that.
No, I was just kidding. Yeah, I take that back. I was kidding. So then I spent like a year and a half training up.
Did you marry her right away?
No, we got engaged after 9 months. Like, I knew right then and there, like, this, she's a badass.
And this history, this dark history that you have, do you share this with her?
Not at this point.
Do you share it with her before you get married?
No.
Wow.
Is
that a dick move?
Yeah, looking back, yeah, you know.
I mean, it's baggage. Like, it's like showing up with
like
your mother-in law.
I fully trust you, but I'm gonna keep this away from you.
Right.
Like, I don't want you to I don't want to bother you with it.
Right.
You know, it's like, I love you so much. I want to keep everything like super.
Is that really it, or is it that fucking I don't want to talk about this?
I didn't want to talk about it. It wasn't like the me saving her. Like, I'm gonna protect you from my stuff. Like, it's like. I'm embarrassed.
Well, it's like things are going so well.
Yeah,
right?
I'm embarrassed.
Yeah.
I'm
like,
embarrassed.
Why talk about the negative if there's so many great things? Like a new relationship, you know what I mean? And that's what I'm thinking. Like kind of all of it in one. Like, it wasn't just the I'm going to protect you from my shit.
And I guess at this point, you still didn't know how much of it really was of you.
And I hadn't processed any of it at this point.
Okay.
Like,
okay.
I had
we'll give you a pass.
Right. I had never, like, really sat down and been like, what is this doing to me?
Okay.
Because of the alcohol.
Okay.
You know, it was like, I'll just feed myself with alcohol and not have to worry about it and talk about it at all.
If you met her now, let's say you didn't have these two boys and you didn't have her now and they were 10 years ahead and you met them at 35, would you tell her now?
Yeah.
You tell someone and then...
I tell everybody.
Okay. Oh, right. Well, shit. You're telling us, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Like, but I think it's... And it's not...
That's the only fucking dumb question I've ever asked on this show.
No,
well, when I asked Leong if there was internet in China, that was not a dumb question. That is like just a great question.
I didn't Elijah went to China and did some seminars, and he was telling me like they can't have like Facebook.
So that's the thing. They have internet there. It's like if you go to a zoo and you see a lion in a cage. Is that really a lion?
Right. Right.
Because that motherfucker's in a cage, and that isn't showing any of the characters. Right. Looks like a lion. Right. None of the characteristics line up. Now, just because you have Wi-Fi and some websites in China, if you can't get out of your country, is that really internet?
Right. I agree.
You see that? See what I'm saying, Matt?
Yeah,
that was like kinda. Like that should be like a Buddha quote. Like that's a Buddha quote.
I didn't like the lion analogy. That's
what if your wife didn't have a vagina? Would she still be your wife?
That what if my grandpa had tits?
I see no parallel to that in a lion in a cage at a zoo. You're getting a little wobbly with these.
No, there's attributes that define something.
See, Eric even thinks so too.
Why? What did Eric do?
He laughed.
That's because he knows I'm right. There's attributes that make something what it is, the essence of it. And if your internet doesn't work outside of your country, if you can't use Google, then you're not on the internet.
Yeah, so there's like I'm
saying underground. Like your standard is different than somebody else's.
Okay. No, that's fine. But my standard's right. So you meet her.
Right.
You're about 1 year in.
Yeah, I'm like, I think we're 19, 20. We get engaged after 9 months. I went to get married before I went to Iraq because of financial reasons.
Like bump and pay.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
They give you more money. And then my parents and her parents were like, I don't know. And then because it's easier to bury a boyfriend in our eyes at the time. Like they talked me into it, than it would be a husband. It might not be something you ever completely get rid of.
That's heavy.
Yeah. I don't think you should ever avoid heartbreak.
Right.
You should never make a decision to avoid heartbreak.
And I agree. And now looking back on it, we both say like, that like trying to fight that love, like for that reason, like we loved each other, like we wanted to be husband and wife at that time, like
right.
That was the reality. But
you didn't get married?
No, we didn't. We got engaged, and then I did 365. I left on her birthday, March 13, 2004, and that we were supposed to be going to Mexico, but they pushed our orders to Iraq sooner. So I didn't like her whole family, like everybody's going to Mexico, and like she's dropping me off at Fort Hood, like. See ya. Like, we don't know.
And then from there, you don't see her for a year?
No, I get leave like right around Thanksgiving time. Most people would take like, you get like 16 days or whatever it is. And some people never want to leave the country, so they would go like to Dubai on like a 4-day pass. Because it was hard coming back. Like after seeing all that fucking crap and going through all that, it was like.
You did see crazy shit over there?
Yeah. And this is like the veteran portion
You get deployed to? Iraq?
I was in southeast Baghdad. So like,
does anyone say Iraq or do they all say Iraq?
Iraq, like Iraq is like if you're like smart, like school wise, or like the people in Iraq say like Iraq or
Iraq.
You know. But it was like,
did you guys not do that because that would be too complimentary towards it? Like was Iraq kind of like the way to degrade it?
No,
yeah,
we're
here fighting in Iraq, blowing some people up.
Most
in Baghdad,
like when we
Iraq,
went, it was like
Iraq. Iraq.
They just called them sons of bitches.
Right.
You know
right.
what I mean?
The enemy.
Like these people, because there was 9 months of fighting in Iraq, and then there was a longer period of time that we'd already been in Afghanistan. And so people we know were already dying. And so like
guys
we had
you went to boot camp with.
Guys I went to basic training with, like three guys I went to basic training with died in either Iraq or Afghanistan the first 9 months.
So you're going over there to kill the guys who killed
mad.
Them.
Yeah, we're mad.
Yeah.
Like it's we'll protect us and whatever else happens, that's on them.
Right.
They didn't take care of their business. We're here to take care of it for you.
Right.
While protecting each other and the innocent.
Right.
Like that was like there's the whole big thing. Like it's me and my buddies first. Like it's our that camaraderie. Like you'll never break. Like it's us or them. And if you didn't look at it that way, like you're probably in the wrong job. Like if you're going to combat and you're thinking like, oh, I can't wait to help. Like, I can't wait to help my buddies. Like this is us and our country and
survival
like,
first.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Like, it's us or them was always said. Remember, it's us or them. Every time before we went out on patrol, it's us or them.
You know? Guys would have that talk
every single time, every single time. And sometimes we were going out doing 3 or 4 2-hour patrols a day. And it was always remember why we're doing this. It is for us so we can go home. And while like the bigger picture, the things we were doing were for the betterment of Iraq, which then helps the United States. Like in my opinion, we can get all into that, but like it was for us. Like, you develop a true love.
And did anyone in your...
Yeah, so in the artillery, so there's like infantry and then there's artillery. We didn't take my battalion of about 1,200 guys. We only took, I think, 4 howitzers. Like, if you pull up a howitzer, it's a tank on steroids. And it shoots these 155-millimeter rounds. And it's badass. I think we took 4 or 6 out of the normal. I think we had 18. Yeah, we had 18. So we only took a couple. We went from artillerymen being inside of these vehicles to being on patrol in not up armored, under armored vehicles that we had to, our mechanics put steel on the sides. So that's, yes. And actually that's not mine, but it's, first battalion.
You were trained to be in one of those?
Absolutely.
And what did you do in there?
So, this is the guy that's in charge. He's the section chief. This is the gunner. And then inside, I was this guy right here. That's not me.
Is there anyone that's like protected? Like, all you guys got your heads out.
Like, the way that IEDs are built, like, you're, like, from gunfire. Like, so you're sitting here, and then there's, like, a little hatch that you crawl, like, get on all fours and crawl out to the back of it. That was the picture before where the back door opened up.
Wow.
So, yeah, that's the inside.
That's where I would be. I'd be in there.
So it's, but it's like,
just so you know, so, never go.
So like,
I'm not one of the dudes with their head.
So like, dibs.
It's so hot in there. You don't want to be in there. That was one thing. Like, I'm a sweater. Like, my little head sticking out. Like, my little head. And it, plus, I had my own little small sleeping quarters. Like, these guys are all laying on each other.
Is there shit in there that's like so fucking hot that if you touch it, you burn yourself? Is it like walking around inside of an
absolutely.
Iron? Like, you're like,
it's an oven. Yeah, like, you, like, the gear, you want your sleeves rolled down. You want the gloves on. Like, you want to be fully, because it's so freaking hot.
Everything in there is bad.
Everything's hot. And so it's like they have like a little primer, and you pull a cord, and that this like little motion like this sends that round miles. You know, it can send it up to miles. So it was like,
so you train, you think you're going to take 18 of those there, but you only take 4.
We learned to walk. Mm-hmm. I learned, and like a lot of people, like, you join this because you don't want to be an infantryman. Like, I'm not going to lie. Like, infantrymen are badass. Like, I wanted to ride in style. Like, look how nice this
looks.
Right,
right.
Like, it's beautiful.
Right.
It's
like a Cadillac. No one can get you a knife.
It's a Cadillac. Like, I can still hurt people, but like, yet I'm protected.
And there's probably like water in there. And
we have water. And there's like, you can like heat water for coffee.
Awesome.
Perfect. You know, it's like my own little hotel room in combat. Wow. But we didn't take those with us. Like, my battery, which was, I think, 130 people, we didn't take any of ours with us. And it was like, okay, well, you're on, you're in the guard towers for a while. So you hear like mortars and stuff. But the third day we're there, Sadr City, which is like one of the worst places in Iraq, it got attacked. Like, they came out of the woodwork. And so we had our infantry battalion was there, another group of infantrymen. And then we had, I think, 90 other artillerymen from my unit attached to there. And they got attacked. And it was called Black Sunday. And so, like, we had to load up and, like, get them ammunition and stuff. And so, like, 4 of our battalion members died that day, 4 days into Iraq. So we got there April 1st, and on the 4th
How many people in the battalion? 1,200?
1,200. So the first 4 are killed within, like, just over 72 hours.
Wow. And these are dudes you would see, like, in the mess hall and shit like that?
Absolutely. Like, especially, like, they were at a different FOB, which is a forward operating base, but, like, you see each other, like, you talk to each other, but, like, back at Fort Hood, it was all, like, you're always together. They were mechanics. Casey Sheehan was a friend of mine, and he was a mechanic. You know, and you see him every single day.
Who is that? I don't know who that is.
So Casey Sheehan, his mom brought what was Camp Casey at Bush's private residence into Camp Crawford. She made up and started putting the crosses up with their boots. She was the original Moms Against Iraq.
Wow. Okay.
So he was from my unit. He was a member of my unit. And then, so, like, we were on guard tower, like...
Yeah, you kill a mama's baby, and she'll have a lot of energy to do a lot of protesting.
There's a long story to that. She wasn't such a great mom, but she kind of let him, you know... Don't want to get too personal. She wasn't the best person, but
right.
So then, like, we were in the guard towers. It was like they're trying to figure out what they were going to do with this. So they put us up in the guard towers, and there's mortars all the time. Like, mortars all the time, and you hear like loud booms everywhere you go. So you're like, oh wow, this is neat. Like, rockets coming in, they sound like fireworks, and it's like, zzz, and it's like you know, you pucker, like you always got to pucker, and I can still like, I get the shakes, like even making that motion, like thinking of that. So then they're like, okay, well, the area we're in is not good. It's not safe. We have to go find the guys that are making IEDs, the guys that are, that have these mortar tubes that are shooting mortars at us, the guys that are driving by shooting, like they're not happy with us. We have to go fix this, this little city town that we're in. So then we just started going out on patrols and working with the people to try to like better the community. But at the same time,
you're looking to hunt these people and kill them.
Yes. While fixing their, while giving,
yeah,
the nice people food, mm-hmm, we're still, there's people hunting. Like you are hunting humans.
Right.
Like that is your job, is we set up like traffic control points with like razor wire all out. And it's like, we're going to find out who the bad guys are.
I have a couple of friends who were Marines, a couple guys in the Navy, a lot of guys who work for CrossFit.
Right. Service. Absolutely.
And I always make this joke when we hear a helicopter. Hey, hey, be cool. Be cool. Yeah. Is that not a cool joke to me?
I don't. It doesn't. Like, I don't. It doesn't bother me.
All right, cool.
You know what I mean? Right. Like, it doesn't.
I do that to Tyson and Dave all the time. Oh, be cool. Be cool. Be cool.
It doesn't bother me, but like, right, things, something that, like boxes on the side of the road, I'm switching lanes. Yeah. Cars on the side of the road, I'm switching lanes. Like, there's, it just, it's instinct. And then, so like the year,
you're not getting blown up, whether it's in Iraq or fucking,
I'm going to do my
Iowa
best to avoid it.
Yep.
Yeah. Like, yep, that's my thought process. My, yep, wife drives 99% of the time. So renting the car here for me was like, I'm a damn grown ass man. I can drive by myself 20 miles. Like, look at me.
And why does she drive? Because of that?
It's
just not a healthy environment for you.
Right.
You driving,
I know what situations to put myself in, what not to, and if letting her drive is avoids any sort of conflict and confrontation, because I still have times where I get mad and I get aggressive, and so to
what
take that away.
What happened there? What incident happened there that was the most traumatic? That
you my carry? First sergeant was killed. He was, when I first arrived.
This is Ernst.
First Sergeant Ernest Utt, yeah.
Ernest Utt, yeah.
My first day at Fort Hood, anyways, like, I went to sign in and, like, welcome me, and he brought me back to his house for barbecue. So, like, right then and there, I was like, this guy's cool. And then he was, like, he was a mentor from that point and always, like, kind of took me under his wing. Like, you know, he was a great, amazing leader. And so I just, like, he was the first person I met at my unit at Fort Hood. And he was just, I mean, he was a leader of leaders. Like, when you looked, like, you just looked at the guy and you knew there was a presence about him. He could, like they always say, find you one that can do both, someone that's an asshole and someone that can be kind. Like, he was the perfect balance of that. Like, he just, when he spoke, you understood that there was no sideways around it. There was no other ways that he was trying to benefit from it but doing the right thing. It was like the middle of the day, and we were, my 4-vehicle team wasn't on patrol at the time. And so my buddy and I, Lon, who also, he follows a podcast and he's a CrossFitter.
Great dude. Great,
amazing.
Dude. Hey, Lon, what's up, man?
Big fan. Shout out, Lon.
we went to like the indoor range that we had, and it wasn't indoor. Like, we went to basically suntan, because like, who doesn't like to be tan?
Shirt off.
So we went, always. And so we went and we came back, and we had adopted puppies from like the outside of the camp. And so we were looking at these puppies, and these puppies would like run over to the sun, and it would be so hot on their feet that they'd run back to the shade. And it was like, wow, like, first starting got these puppies, that's so cool. And then all of a sudden, like, I'm thrown from my feet, Lawn's knocked over. And they had fired a 120-millimeter rocket, pinpointed to the exact location. I mean, it was a building, and it was, he stood outside, and a lot of times, like, you duck for cover, like, cover your ass.
Wait a sec. So this is a military base.
Yeah, it's a FOB.
And
it was Camp Cuervo was the name of it.
And what's FOB stand for?
Forward Operating Base.
Uh-huh, Camp Cuervo. And you guys are outside doing some target practice,
yeah,
sunbathing, looking at your puppies,
yeah,
and a fucking,
taking a break.
And a fucking missile? Bullet,
yeah.
Giant bullet?
I mean, it's 122 millimeters. It's fucking phenomenal.
And when that one hits, does that hurt anyone?
It killed him. It hit him. So
oh,
it didn't
shit.
Hit the, like, it hit him. And normally, like, to make sense, like, the leadership would always look to see where it would come from, so they could identify, call on their radio, and then we can shoot back.
Right.
And it was like, he obviously was out. He was looking for it, and it.
Because he heard it coming, or someone,
yeah,
spotted
you could
on
hear
radar?
It. You could hear the initial poof. And then it's like, you hear it all the time.
So did you know when, did you hear that?
I never did.
Not that time.
I didn't hear it coming.
But he did.
He was out like looking for it, obviously. Like,
was
that
anyone else killed?
No, he was, and that was.
How many people were at this FOB?
I want to say 400 maybe.
So he had a very slim chance of being the one to get hit, and he got hit.
And he was the one that took it.
And when you get hit by that, is there anything left of you? You're gone.
That was there wasn't an open casket. I can tell you that. So it was that reality, like it threw me from my feet. And like I'm like seeing stars. I'm like, holy shit, did that really just happen? And I see Lon, and Lon like had ran over there and ran back, and he was like, you don't, like, you're good, like just go away. So I was like, what's he talking about? So I went to see, and then
you could see he was dead.
Yeah. And so I just, I mean, I wasn't saving.
And were there people screaming and running around? And
it wasn't necessarily scream. It was controlled chaos. Like,
why did they only shoot one in?
I don't know. Probably.
They only had one?
Yeah, probably guessing, right?
Scared what was going to happen next, to see what would happen. And what's crazy is it was.
And what does happen next?
All hell broke loose.
You guys leave.
You let the dogs out. You let the dogs out. Like, people were mad. Like, you just took our hero away. Like, the guy that is in charge, like, our commander and him were the perfect team pair, like, together. Like, one was, like, this professional, awesome, like, super Billy badass, and the other one was the leader, like, the NCO. So they made a perfect team, and you took one away from us. You took dad away from us. So it was like, okay. Like, we had a quick formation. It was, you know, yeah, he's dead. We're going out on patrol, and we're going to go find what it was. And it was the... Like, what's crazy was, like, the house that you could see outside of our FOB. Like, it was, there was, the Diala River, I think it was right there. And it was, like, this nice house. And they just, like, put it on rock and, like, a firework. Like, you would do bottle rocket. Like, if you just tip over the bottle and then you light it and see where it goes, like, that's what they did.
And then, so did you guys destroy the house?
No, it was too close. Like, did we want to? Absolutely. It was just too close. There was, there were a lot of things that happened, but the house wasn't destroyed. There was a lot of attitude adjustments. But it was just like, it was so like hard to grasp that he was.
Do you ever catch the people who did it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, they were caught.
Yeah. And like, it was an entire family. I don't know. They're shipped off somewhere else.
Are they killed or are they?
No, they're not. It's not like you're definitely, they're not murdered. You know what I mean? Like they were.
That's some pretty amazing restraint.
They were, yeah. I mean, but it's like the reality, like, and that was the thing, like, my section told us, like, do you want him to die in vain? Like, is this like revenge? Is that what you want? Like, is this what's going to happen? And it was like, how can we do this? You know, it's like, okay, well now hand them off to their own people. And like the Iraqi police were not nice to him. I don't know what happened to him afterwards, but they weren't nice to him. And then, so that was kind of a turning point for me. I went to the promotion board within the next 2 weeks, and he was gone. He wasn't there to, like, they sit in front of you and they ask you questions, and you give answers, basically a test.
Do you break down there?
Oh, bad.
In front of the promotion board?
Bad. They threw me out, and I had to catch my shit. They're like, we're going to give you a chance. Go catch your shit and come back in. So I did the non-commissioned officer's creed. Came back in and did the non-commissioned officer's creed, and they said, we know that he's
what
not...
Is that?
It's, yeah,
what is that?
It's known as more professional than I am a non-commissioned officer, leader of soldiers. It's just when you go from specialist E4 in the Army to E5, you damn better well know the non-commissioned officer creed, because becoming an NCO is an important...
Okay, and you position. Say that. It's something you verbalize. It's like
so
a pledge of allegiance.
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Okay. And if you don't know it, you're a turd.
Okay.
You know, so they test you on it, and it's long, and... So I originally came in, and I was looking at where he would be sitting, and they had replaced him with another member, a senior non-commissioned officer in my battalion, and they could tell I wasn't right. So they were like, the sergeant major was like, I'm going to give you a chance. Get out and come back in and give me the NCO creed. And I think they asked me one more question after that, and usually it's a couple minutes long. And they asked me one more question, and then they said, okay, get out. And then so I passed, and so it was like –
you got the promotion.
Yeah. And I didn't get on the point. It goes by points. So I had to submit my points. I think I got it like a month later. But walking back, it was like, fuck. You know, like, this sucks. This is terrible.
Oh, you weren't elated. You weren't like, yeah, I did it.
No. My section chief was with me and my roommate, my roommate the entire time I was in the military back, and it was like, man, this like sucks. My section chief was like, you know, but he would be proud. we're going to do these things for him. You're going to make him proud, you know, these things. But it's still, like, wasn't the same after that. It just wasn't, you know, a couple months in, and it was like everybody's attitude switched to mad. Like, it was people were pissed. And then slowly more and more people started to be killed. And people...
people in your battalion.
Yeah. Not as many, even in, like, there were people, and I don't want to say not as many that it's not important, because it's very important, but, like, our infantry battalion, they got rocked in Sadr City. And when I say rock, I don't mean that to demean the people that they lost. Like, it kills me to even, like, talk about it. But they took a lot of loss. And guys that you would see on a consistent basis, it was different guys the next time. It was a different set of guys. It was a different group of guys. And so, like, that, like, revolving door just never stopped. It was, the phones are off because so-and-so died.
And are you thinking every day you can be killed?
Every day. Every day it's like, well, you know, at night I'm like, in my head I'm like, thank God. And then I'm like, why the hell is God doing this to me? You know?
So you had faith then?
I had it. I didn't know how to use it. Okay. I didn't know how to really give myself. And I like with Sam Dancer, like, I didn't, like, listening to him, like, it was pretty good the way he explains it. It's like, I believe, but I didn't know how to believe. I didn't know how to use my faith. Like, I'm not perfect, but I didn't have that actual what's faith of, you know, I questioned everything. Mm-hmm. Of even, like, when I was a kid, like, why is this happening to me? Like, if this man is so great and he does all these great things, why are these happening? But it wasn't until, you know, later on that I got that all figured. I got that all figured out. But it's
a woman, right?
Right.
It's not a man. Right. I think that's the first thing everyone has fucked
I think
up.
He's from Baja. It's Jesus, is what. Yeah. But it's
talking about God here. So yeah. Lost me there.
Matt, don't fall asleep. People judge the shit out of you for the Ronnie Teasdale episode.
Yeah, I'm not falling asleep. I'm just focusing.
Did you roll your eyes at anything he said?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, geez, people are just like slaying me. You're the one who needs to get slayed.
But it's, there's plenty of slaying to me, motherfucker. Okay.
But it's like that year.
That's 2 years in.
It's 2 years in.
How often are you talking to your wife back home? Do you have one of those satellite phones you can call?
No, I don't. No? I think people had bought some. I didn't like to call home. I didn't like to write home. I didn't like to receive letters. I like to receive snacks because snacks are important.
Do you think about your wife a lot?
Yeah.
Oh, when you're over there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
where did you do you have any alone time there? Where did you?
We made alone time.
Yeah.
Like, it was kind of a scheduled, like, hey, you.
Here's your 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Go.
Like, here's your
here's your rub one out.
Yeah. Here's your. Okay. Yeah. And they had a lot of neat things, like, my wife's not going to be very proud that it was called Fifi's. And uh-huh. It's a toilet paper roll, and you stuff toilet paper inside of it, and you can put lotion. I never did it because I was fine. Like, it never had to have.
Fifi is like a homemade pocket pussy.
It's like a pocket vagina.
Wow. Amazing.
And then, and some guys like you, like, people think when I joke about it, like, they cut holes in their mattresses and then you could put the Fifi in there. Like, I never did it. And I didn't, like,
but there'd be other dudes in the room.
No, I, like, you would leave.
Oh,
like,
okay.
You could, like, everybody go get dinner, chow, like, or you're going on patrol. I'm not going out today. Like,
catch up with you guys later.
Yeah. like when your kids go to school for the first day and you're out waving, like, bye. Like,
I'm leaving. Like, I'll be back in 15
It's my
minutes.
Time.
Hey, do you have any pictures? I'd love to see that mattress with a hole in it.
I don't have any. I burned all my pictures in Kuwait on the way back.
Did you?
I was smart. Hmm. Yeah.
Oh, and why is that?
Because a lot of the pictures weren't
incriminating.
Yeah. I wouldn't say incriminating, but it was like, then you start to feel guilty because you're so excited to go back home and you're like, look at your picture and it's like, oh shit. I don't need those pictures.
Yeah. Okay. Does any part of you wish you still had them?
Yeah. Oh. I burned, like, throughout my time, I burned uniforms. I threw medals away, like military medals. I threw coins out.
All stuff you wish you would have kept.
All stuff I wish I would have kept.
But that was your way of saying fuck you.
Fuck you. Yeah.
Okay. And did you have a picture of your wife the whole time you were there?
Yeah, I had a lot. Some of them got burned in Kuwait on the way back just so that no one else got to see them. Right. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, why? Because as you checked in, you had to empty out your pockets and show everyone what you're coming back to the station.
Yeah, like, or like a lot of guys, like, the pictures on their computers, like, that pictures were sent to there, they deleted those, and mine were all like pictures that I would, like, keep under my mattress next to Fifi.
Right.
No, I'm kidding. I didn't have a Fifi, I promise.
Oh, these are like...
Yeah, they're... Yeah, oh. They're... Yeah, and oh, she's not going to be happy with... Because she's pretty conservative, but...
Gotcha.
It's...
Hey, you can't send 100,000 men overseas and not give them an outlet.
No. It was weird. And thankfully, at that time, Facebook wasn't cool. There was like no Instagram. You know what I mean? There wasn't. I don't know what they do now, but like back then, it was like pictures in the mail, or like every once in a while, you'd have like webcam access. You'd get like that perfect internet connection. It was like I think it was 9 hours difference, and so like be like, hey, good morning, like wake up, like pop tit. You know what I mean? Like, like this, you know, and I hate, like, I joke about that, but like, that was like, oh, cool. I'm good. Right. You know what I mean? Like, I'm good to go.
You bought me
like,
48 hours.
Yeah. Like I'm good to go. And that's the reality. I think that not a lot, like that's something the, like being away sucks.
So you're away for how long are you?
365 days to the day.
And then you come back. And are you ever deployed again?
Never. No.
Okay.
I have 1 year. After I get back, I have just under a year left. Mm-hmm. I was going to reenlist, but.
And do you move in with your wife at that point?
Yeah, she had gotten an apartment right like a week before I left. 2 weeks before I left, I think it was.
Right by the base.
No. No, I'm smart. I was smart enough to know that there was none of that. Like, she's 40 minutes away. Oh, because another dude will scoop her up? Oh, for sure.
Oh, okay.
Or at least try to.
Right.
Like, so we, in the town that she, like, went to high school and we got an apartment, like, where she was working.
So you come back from this barbaric fucking experience.
And I'm fine. Fucking fine. I'm good.
You're severely traumatized.
Right.
As is everyone, right? You're not alone.
Right.
Your fiance at the time?
Yeah, she's my fiance.
So we were getting, I got back in March. For 4 years. 5 years.
Well, no, it was, we got engaged at, God, when was it? So Christmas Eve 2003, I left March 2004.
So for years you've been engaged.
2 years. Okay. Yeah, 2 years.
And then you come back and you do the commute from base to your apartment. That's for another 40 year. Minutes each
yeah,
way.
We got married in August of 2005 after I got back in March, got married in August, and then I got out of the military like the 1st of March.
And you 2006. Come back and just start drinking right away?
Right back on it. That night, I'm...
The day you
we
land.
Go, yeah, like my mom and stepdad are there, and we go to their hotel room, and I just, like, I get into the whiskey like it's nobody's business, and everything's, I'm so happy to see everybody. I puke on the way home. Like, I open the car door, turning to go to our apartment, like, making the turn, I remember it, and my wife's, like, got a hold of me, and I'm, like, puking.
And before then, when was the last time you'd had a drink?
I drank in Iraq.
Oh, you did, okay.
I won't attempt to say that I was, like, yeah, like, I had some drinks in Iraq.
And is that illegal?
I think it's against their religion and...
But I mean against military policy.
Oh, yeah. For sure. Oh,
okay.
For sure.
So where do you get the alcohol at?
The locals have it. Like, they can... The Iraqis can pretend that they're, like... They drink.
Okay.
So gotcha. There's, like... They get, like, the stout beer, you know, like, the high percentage of alcohol, and then they have, like... They get, like, whiskey, and then they take...
Did you ever get sick there? Drink so much you got sick there?
Oh, yeah. Oh, one night I lost it. I flipped shit, and they knew that I had been drinking... and so I got put on guard tower duty.
Your commanders?
My platoon sergeant.
Okay.
My section chief, the guy that was just in charge of me, knew that I needed some, you know, a kick in the ass. So I was taking off patrol, which you don't want to be not on patrol, like, because then you're not in the mix. You're just hanging out on the guard tower.
Right.
So I had to do that. And it was something terrible, like, for 4 hours, you get 2 hours off, then you go another 4 hours and you get 2 hours off. And I was like, fuck, I get it. Like,
what do you do in those 2 hours you sleep?
Miserable. No, okay. I think I'm probably sick. You know what I mean? Like, I don't really remember, like, what I didn't get it. Like, I got it. Okay, I can't do this anymore. I got it. Like, put me back in, coach.
Gotcha.
Mission accomplished. And, like, they sat down and they're like, you do it again and it's gonna be worse.
When do you have your first experience with pills?
I would say.
Did you ever shoot anything up?
No. Needle, like, I am covered in tattoos, but, like, needles just weren't my thing. It always seemed dirty.
Okay.
To me, and pills were, like, clean, you know, like, and I don't want to be looked at as, like, as dirty.
So no meth or coke either?
I had some experience with coke.
After your return?
Yeah. After, like, all out of the military. I never did any drugs. I didn't even take any pills. When I was in the military, then when I got out, I had a lot of trouble sleeping. And I actually went to work for the sheriff's office in Travis County in Austin for 2.5 years. And, like, within the first 6 months there, I was on pills.
Yeah, they just handed out, like, candy, right?
Prescribed. Oh, prescribed.
Like, it was, oh, yeah, prescribed, not prescribed. I could get somebody else's prescription.
How much weight do you put on in that first 6 months getting out?
The first probably 40 pounds at that point.
So you're about where you are now, 220. You quickly blow up to like...
Well, I was about 200 the whole time I was in the military.
Okay.
And then I get to, like by the time I in Iraq, and then when I get out of Iraq, I'm about 220, 230, and then within the first 6 months, I'm probably 275.
Oh, shit. Are you doing some weird shit in Iraq, too? Like eating two, what are those meals called?
MREs, meals ready to eat.
Yeah, are you eating more?
We had...
like 10,000 calories at a time, right?
We had those, like, they constipate you.
Okay.
So they kind of, like, there's some good stuff. Like, they got Skittles in them. And so there's, like, some okay meals. But, like, we had a chow hall. Which was basically a circus tent, and they had a hot meal. And so like I just ate like that, but you were using so many calories, you know, an extra 40, 60, 80 pounds of
gear. Did you notice you were eating more though than other guys?
No, I didn't pay. Like
yeah, I don't think it really matters at that point.
Dude, at that point, he weighs
200 fucking pounds. Yeah, but
you're in survival mode.
Yeah, at that point.
Yeah,
like,
but no one wants to be like, with
mine was like
20 in the tank.
A lot of we were in Humvees. Like I could still there's some pictures, I think on here, of me like, you know, I was getting bigger. You know, like I was definitely like eating my feelings. Like there's no doubt about it because I wasn't able to drink as much. Like there was a handful of times I had a drink. But it was a lot of it was like eating and like tons of like crap, you know. It was like care packages would come and I could eat like they had like Ritz crackers, like flaky type crackers, and I'd pound the whole thing in like 2 minutes.
Right,
and they're delicious.
Ritz crackers are good.
Yeah, they're delicious. They're like they got a little air. Like they're.
I
delicious.
Lived on them as a kid.
Yeah,
as a
just
kid.
The regular they're butter so, ones.
Yeah,
just the round.
Now they have like
just put one in at a time. Even as a kid,
then you could. Like squirt cheese on there, the canned cheese. Like that was a big thing over there. Like
hey, easy cheese.
Easy cheese. Yeah, like easy that's cheese, that goes that makes anything gourmet. Like over there, anything over there, easy
and
cheese.
And now it's peanut butter for even, you.
Yeah, now it's peanut butter. I've moved up.
So you're at the sheriff's office. A doctor prescribes you some pills.
Yeah, I get some prescriptions and then it's not enough. So like I go on my own.
Like what?
Yeah, what kind of pills?
Like trazodone was one.
Wow. I used to work in a home for disabled adults. We gave that to them.
Oh yeah.
What is it?
And that's how I knew of it, because at the jail, that's what you get people that have severe mental illness to go to sleep.
Is that an opioid?
I have no idea, but I think it's hardcore shit.
Yeah, I forget the category it falls under, but basically it's like you're gonna go to sleep for 12 hours.
Oh. Okay.
Good night.
Yeah.
Like there's no thought process. Like,
it's like
so
a
it
horse,
was explained
like
to me later
localizer?
By one of my coaches, he was like, he worked for a sleep station. He's like, it is shutting off your brain.
He worked for a what?
Like they do sleep testing.
Oh, okay.
His name's Cade. He goes to my gym and he said, I was like, so what's this trazodone do? And he's like, basically it is stopping all brainwave movement for a period of time.
And would you take it to sleep or would you take it to function?
I started out taking it, mixing it with Ambien. To get good night's rest. But then I started to be like you could make a concoction of different pills to achieve.
And you're getting prescribed enough to fulfill your addiction.
Absolutely.
And is your wife tripping?
No idea.
She doesn't know?
My wife thought that like at one point my wife gave me a hydrocodone.
Mm-hmm.
And she was like, I was like, this is fucking cool. And she's like, you're done. Like, that's it. So she had no idea. Like, there was no, for 9 years, my wife had no idea that I was a drug addict. Zero.
Amazing.
Like, I was getting drugs from anyone and everyone. And most of the time, I didn't have to pay for it. Whether it was through the VA prescribing me pills, or through friends that had prescriptions for these pills, or for friends' wives.
So is the U.S. government a major purchaser of...
Absolutely. And that's why I have put myself in the middle of this with the pain management director of my VA, who's a friend of mine and a member of one of our sister gyms, because it's out of hand. It's crazy. Like I could have, at one point, I could have 90 Oxycontin and 90 Trazodone pills delivered from Omaha to my front door in 24 hours.
Service with a smile.
At one time, not now. Now the policies are changing.
Now you have Uber bring it.
Right.
How old is your oldest child?
6.
So when you and what's his name?
Tucker.
When you have when your wife has Tucker, are you at the hospital?
Yeah. I mean, I'm physically there.
And you're just
high on a kite.
Yeah, wow.
High and hungover. I'd been drinking the night before. She was like, I remember she was walking like to try to get the baby out around the block, and I was across the street at a neighbor's house. Like,
you weren't walking with her?
Hell no.
Wait, two things. Walking to get the baby out?
I don't know the physical what it does, but like if right before
you'll know in 9 months, man.
Your day, like so.
I have a cat.
Like to get the things moving and flowing better. She was somewhat dilated.
You walked the woman, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So like when you don't jump on a trampoline
when you're
to like
when you're that close, you just yeah you walk the woman and get gets things going.
Yeah, and they like, say like if you have sex, it helps do it. So, but like at that time, I was 335 pounds. Like it was not there was I was not happy with myself. Like there was none of that shit going on. So yeah, I just sat and I
335.
Oh yeah.
And your wife is 9 months pregnant. And that day. Do you remember feeling anything when the baby came out? Did you get any of that?
I mean, I was so happy. Like, it was like, oh, that's my boy. And I'm like, but I'm a piece of shit.
Oh,
so,
you did feel that way.
Oh, yeah.
So there had been some crazy self-talk now going on.
Yeah, it's like my self-hate from 2006 to 2012 when he was born, it started to get bad.
What is bad? Like, do you cry every day?
Every night.
Every night?
Every single night I was crying myself to sleep.
And does your wife know that?
No.
You don't even let her see or hear that. Just smash
like she would know, like when I would drink and it would come out. Like she knew that I was struggling, and she would try to like help as much as she could. But like,
was your unhealthy lifestyle getting off on her too? Like, was she starting to drink more? Did she start popping pills?
She went with the flow. Like she would drink, but she was never the issue when we were drinking. You know what I mean? Like there was like one instance one time, and I'm gonna call her out because it was pretty funny. Like we both got like intoxicated, and she got really mad, so she was like throwing ranch out of the bottle in the air. Like that's ranch abuse.
Love
like,
ranch.
That's a lot. Yeah. Like why would you do that?
Do not mess around.
You know, like why are you
mustard
ruining the
maybe,
ranch? Like I'm trying to like catch it with pizza rolls, you know? And it's like don't do that.
But other than that, it was always. Your drama.
Always me starting the shit single time.
At this point, had you already addressed the issues you had in your past as a child?
Yes. Like we had talked about that as being one of my issues. Like I threw a bunch of my medals and awards into the fireplace and like started the fire.
It's just the two of you.
Yep, just the two of us. Like 12 o'clock at night, and like the next morning she's like, okay, we need to talk, we need to discuss this. Mm-hmm. We need to, what's going on? And I like,
no we don't, I need beer.
Yeah. And it was like, okay, well this is what happened, you know, and I've lost my stuff at this point, and I'm bawling and crying, and like she's like, I had no idea, like that's a lot, like okay, like let's work through this. And I'm like, nah, I'm good, I just had a bad night last night, you know. She's not confrontational, so like she's also holding that all inside, all of the shit that I'm doing she's holding inside as well.
I'm in this marriage. It's getting fucking worse. Yeah. Fuck, I'm pretty sure this is alcoholism.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my fucking
But how
God.
Do I approach this yeah. monster?
Yeah.
How do I slay the dragon?
Yeah. I bet you that's how it is for my wife.
what was your drink of choice?
My wife told me one time, everything is about timing with you. And that always made me feel bad. That kind of stuck with me.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, fuck.
That's
right.
Spot on.
I want to always be approachable. I don't want to
yeah.
be like a fucking hungry hippo
yeah.
in marble.
And that's yeah. funny you say that, like yeah. hungry hippo. That's how I was. Like it just one little thing and it was like, oh, man. Like, there he goes. And I can remember my wife, like, me going after another guy and my wife being like, oh, there he goes again. You know?
You mean like at a restaurant starting a fight or something?
Oh, like at a bar. Like a club, I guess, if you want to call it, in a grocery store.
Just wherever.
Wherever it was. One of my big things was, like, if a guy was, like, talking crap to his wife or girlfriend at a bar, like, I would put myself in the middle of that. But at the same time, I'm doing that. You know what I mean? Like, I go home and I'm like, you don't understand me and you don't get it and you're trying to control me and all these things. And it's like pushing all my problems off to the side and like blaming her. So she's like getting.
So go on the offensive whenever you feel defensive.
Right. Absolutely.
You have your second. How old's your second kid?
Truett just turned two.
That's Lunchbox, right?
Lunchbox. Okay. It's lunchy.
And Truett. When he's born,
right before he was born, so he's born in March, August of he was born March of 2016, so July 2015, like shit's just getting bad. It's getting real bad. And my wife's in CrossFit, and she's like, "Why won't you try CrossFit?" I'm like,
"How did she find it?"
She went trying to fix her life. Like she went seeking better, and so she had tried Kosama. She's like, "It's not enough." So she's like,
"Tried what?"
Kosama, it's like a HIIT, high intensity interval training, like not a lot of
a ripoff.
Yeah, like a false advertisement.
I've never heard of them all, but I've never heard of
Kosama. Yeah, so it's I don't know, it's interval training, I guess, something like that. And it's like, so she's trying to better.
I just want everyone to know that my stance on that, like, all movement is good, but fuck you if you're ripping us off. Like, just affiliate and become a CrossFit gym.
Yes,
but
you are.
Get off the couch.
If you have a fucking rope in your gym and kettlebells and shit like that, you are a fucking ripoff.
Okay? Yeah, and I agree. Like, I completely agree with that. So she goes into this CrossFit thing, and I had actually seen a couple guys doing like rope swings, and like, oh, cool, you guys are, and they were special forces.
I want to go back to how she got into it. Sorry. Did she ever go to the gym when you first met her?
Like, she had a personal trainer, like for right before I went to Iraq. Yeah, like Gold's or something like that. Okay. So it was 24
hours. And did you used to go to Gold's with her?
No, hell no.
No, you didn't do that?
No. I didn't want any part of that.
Did you work out at all when you were deployed?
No, there was like a small room of gym equipment. It was like biceps and triceps. And
you didn't have any weights at home, like just some dumbbells to do curls or shoulder press or nothing? Okay.
Nothing. Like.
And did you ever do anything physical with her? Like running or play
frisbee?
We
ran a couple times. And I would like, I think I remember two different times. Like she's trying to better, you know what I mean? And it's like, oh yeah, I'll run with you. I'm better. Like I can run with you. I'm in the army. But it was like never, it was another, something we never did together.
And who turned her on to CrossFit?
Herself. We lived in West Des Moines, and there's an affiliate like a mile from us. So she's like, I think I'm gonna try this CrossFit thing. I'm like, you're a nerd. I'm like, cool.
what was the name of the affiliate?
CrossFit Waukee. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. And it was, and now looking back, it was like being just judgmental. You know what I mean? Like she's better than herself, and I'm
that takes
sucking.
Balls to go into a CrossFit gym. Good
like
honor.
Walked in on her own, met with the affiliate owner, did all this, and I started to get kind of jealous. Like, why are you better than yourself, and I'm just this turd? So it feeds onto my victim. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And she's better than herself, and instead of at that point stepping up and being like, I could follow her lead and, you know, humbling myself and be like, wow, if she's doing this, I can do it. Like, I got at this point, then the drugs hit bad. You know, like, it was.
Like, she's at CrossFit doing Murph and you're fucking doubling down on
it. It's funny you say that
because
that's exactly what happened. She goes and does Memorial Day Murph, and I was like, I'm looking on the website. I'm like, oh, whatever. I don't want to do this. This is silly. And she tells me what it's for, and I'm like, you don't know anything about that. Like, what do you know about military guy? You know, like, wait, don't put yourself in all that. What are you doing? And so, like, I'm jealous at this point. And, like, so then I start to play victim, and it gets worse and worse and worse. And she's, like, excelling, like, getting way better, like, getting abs, you know what I mean? And, like, loving this new transformation and things. And I'm just.
And she's getting new friends.
Yeah. And these friends aren't my friends or anything that I have ever known. So then she gets pregnant in 2015, and I start my free week. We go to I start a free week like in July, and we come back from Mexico, and I'm like, oh, I don't know. So I went
you
back.
You go to Mexico as a fucking drug addict?
Oh, bud.
That must have been wild.
That's how you score.
Holy shit.
That's the same thing like Vegas.
Yeah, wow.
Vegas was my jam.
So you and her went to Mexico with with your child?
No, he stayed at home with her parents that lived in Texas. So we flew from Des Moines to Austin, dropped one kid off.
Is she ever saying to you, does she ever say to you, hey, man, because she doesn't know.
Yeah.
But she knows about your drinking.
She knows. I'm at this point, I'm on like an anxiety medication. Mm-hmm. And like I cry because I'm like, oh, I don't want to take this medicine. I'm really hurting because on top of this medicine that she just thinks I'm starting, I'm on six other different kinds of
prescriptions. And where do you keep those? Where do you hide them?
I think they're one of my socks.
Okay.
Like just the big drawer. Fluffy winter socks that like she's not going to pick up because it's wintertime.
Filson makes some great ones.
Keep it hidden in a
right.
Fifi.
And I put it next to Fifi because I know she's not touching Fifi.
Right.
So it's like, we get back from Mexico, and she got pregnant in Mexico. So then, like, July.
Can sperm be damaged by any of that?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Like, man, you're lucky you got good kids.
Yeah. Huh? And that was a huge part of the process, like the wake-up call. So, like, July 30th, they had, like, a volleyball social at this CrossFit that I'd like, done my free week at. And so I, like, go, and I'm like, oh, yeah, these people are cool.
Whoa, stop. Sorry. You come back from Mexico, and now your wife is, like, how many months into CrossFit? 4 or 5 months?
Yeah.
And how does she get you to do your free week?
I think she kind of – another veteran at my gym. She said, oh, there's another guy, a veteran at our gym, Rich. And you'd really like him. Like, you guys would hit it off. And I'm like, cool. Okay, like, I trust another veteran. Everybody, I'm not going to let my guard down for anybody else. So I go and do this. And he's loud and outspoken. And he's, like, 15 years older than me. So he's got his stuff figured out. Like,
and how long has he been doing the gym?
I think he was a year or two into CrossFit.
So he was in great shape.
Oh, he's phenomenal.
Okay.
Like, he's close to 50, and, like, he's just...
an animal.
Oh, it's yeah, like, strict push-ups. So, like, he did all of the handstand push-ups, he did strict.
Awesome.
Like, fantastic. Uh-huh. Two standard.
I commend that.
You know, and it's like, wow, just think if, like, we could get you to... Not we, like, the coaches were like, just think if we could get you to kip, Rich. Like, but his, like, everything, like, strict pull-ups. Strict, so, like, he's using his fitness.
Good
like
for
he's
him.
Got it.
Good for him.
So then,
so you go in that first day. Are you scared?
I don't. High.
You are high.
Oh yeah.
Are you drunk also?
No, I was hungover. Okay. I remember that being hungover.
And what do you wear?
I don't like basketball shorts and
Triple X T-shirt.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Like
it's
it
a,
was.
It's a good question.
I think at this time, I think I had gotten down. I think it was at 300.
Okay.
The day that I joined. I can't, like, because when right before she had Tucker, I was 335. I think I'd gotten down to three. I don't remember the exact amount.
And how do you do that?
Basically, it was more drinking and drugs than food. Like, I would not eat before I drank because then it ruined my drunk. So it was like one meal, like a huge meal. You know what
right.
I mean?
Like, all right.
Or like a pizza was my thing. Like, one pizza a day, and that was, like, it. So, oh, how did
it's
I?
Funny, it's funny. I do the opposite. I eat so that I can have more than half a beer. If I don't eat, I'm half a beer. I'm
yeah.
fucking sideways.
So then I walk into the gym and I'm like, I'll give this a shot. And I liked it right away. The camaraderie, like no, I didn't feel odd at all. Like I felt like I'd known these people, and like everybody's like, oh, Tiffany told us all these great things about you, and I'm like, wow, that's nice of her. Like she's. Might be lying, you know what I mean? Like she's showing the good side. Like this is cool. And
what was the workout?
It was Fran.
First day.
Oh yeah.
Probably wasn't. I was prescribed, right?
No, I don't even. I think I had the training bar.
It's
and
good.
Because I'm like, oh, I can do 95 pounds. Like this is easy peasy. And they were like, no, you can't. Like he was like, please listen to what I'm saying and do this training.
And
part.
Who was that? Who was the coach?
It was Reggie Hoig. He's yeah. the affiliate owner.
Okay.
And
you you've talked about him a lot in our email exchanges.
Oh, I love him.
And on your Instagram.
I love him.
Yeah.
He, because one, it's really awkward for him to tell him that I like how much I appreciate him. So like, he's like, yeah, I get it. I know. Thank you. You know what I mean? Like,
three
cool.
kisses per
cool.
visit.
Yeah. He's like, yeah, I got it. Shakes my hand and runs off. But
you do love him to death.
Yeah. And at this point, like I started to feel better and like people are like, how can we help you? Like you're a veteran that's struggling.
Day one.
How can we help you? So that like a week into it, they have this volleyball social. And I'm like, all these people, like I'm going to have to tell the truth about my problems. Eventually these people. So I attempt to overdose. At the volleyball thing, I'm like taking trazodone after trazodone, drinking and smoking in the parking lot with my 2.5-year-old son in hand.
Weed
thinking
or?
These no, just cigarettes. Uh-huh. And thinking I'm gonna have to tell the truth to these people, I don't know if I can. So I'm gonna do the opposite.
What made
I'm gonna quit.
You what made you think that you were gonna have to tell them the truth?
Because how much they cared. How much they were like reaching out to me, like whether it was, hey, why don't you come to my church? Hey, you know, why don't you guys come over to our house for dinner and you know, our kids can play together. Or, hey, you guys want to hang out and do this weekend? I'm like...
This sounds like a church, not a CrossFit gym.
Well, it was...
I'm just joking, by the way. Right. It sounds like a CrossFit gym.
But it was so like...
Community's amazing.
To me, it's like, I'm not ready for this. Like, and being not ready for it is, I'm so drunk and high. Like, I have no concept of reality. Hmm. Like, it's just like this big buttered mess. And like, well, I don't want to let my guard down and be vulnerable to these people. You know what? What if I let them down? So I attempt to overdose. My wife and I, after the volleyball thing, my wife's like 8 months pregnant, going to school, has a full-time job, goes to school full-time to be an esthetician, completely bettering herself while I'm this turd and I'm like, I'm done with it. Like, I can't do this to her. We're going to have another baby in like 4 or 5 months. I don't want to be that dad. So I attempt to overdose at dinner. She goes to the bathroom and I take an entire 30 pills of trazodone.
Is this the same night as the volleyball?
Yeah.
So when you're at the volleyball tournament, do they know? Can people just see that you're fucked up?
They knew I was drinking. I've never asked Like, it's kind of weird. Did you know I was screwed up? Like, I never asked that. Like, hey, did you know?
Will you go back and do
that?
Before you come back for your next visit, you need to find
that
out.
Like, I ask, like, Aaron Newberry, who's one of the coaches at ours. Like, we talk a lot about my addiction because I was very open with her from the beginning. And it was like, she was like, oh, I could tell you were drinking. And I knew that you were in a bad spot. And she was very, like, she was approachable. But I was like, yeah, whatever. You know what I mean? Like, get out.
Is that you right there?
That's me.
Yeah, you look 20 years younger now.
Yeah. And that's crazy. John Hintz. He's another veteran.
Mm-hmm.
He retired from the Army, and he owns
he's like a hoss.
My tattoo artist. He's a badass.
Yeah, he looks
like
owns, it from the back.
He owns Warrior Tattoo in Waukee. And he's taking me in right away.
Your wife's going to CrossFit for 5 or 6 months. She gets you to come in because there's a veteran there. Good move on her part. What's your wife's name?
Tiffany.
Tiffany. Good job, Tiffany.
Tiff.
And
Tiff.
You do it for a week, and you're liking it, and you feel safe, and you feel welcome, and you almost feel too welcome, and you feel like, oh, shit, I'm going to let the cat out of the bag, and I do not want to do that. You go to a volleyball social after being in CrossFit for a week, and while you're there, you pop a lot of pills.
Yeah.
And you have your two-year-old
in your hand.
No one says to you, hey, this is fucked up, or...
They didn't know. Like, I wasn't doing it out in front of them. Like, I would, like, walk to my car. So, like, here's the volleyball.
Like, take a Trazodone and chase it with a Bud Light?
Absolutely. Like, have it in my swim trunks.
Well,
like,
you're probably pretty good at it by then.
I'm professional.
For years.
Yeah.
Professional. So, and while I would take a Trazodone...
Are you high on anything now?
No.
Okay.
I'm almost 3 years sober.
Awesome.
Off everything.
What about caffeine? Do you drink coffee?
When he says we wouldn't
I drink,
know.
Like, Amino Energy. They sold at Costco, like coffee.
It's like
but it's like, then I went like 15 of them. You know what I mean? Then I'm like,
I understand.
I'm like, I want more and more and more.
Fresh pods. So then you go, and your wife's at the volleyball social.
Yeah. No, she's at esthetician school while I'm pregnant. She's at esthetician school pregnant while I'm at the volleyball social with my 2-year-old.
You finish up there. Were you on the winning team?
I don't even think I played.
Okay.
I was busy.
You go home.
Right.
You drive home.
Yeah.
Fucked up with your
hammered.
Kid. You, which is okay in Iowa. You.
It's acceptable. You can leave kids in the car too.
You then are at home. You put your son. Your
we
son
get a babysitter.
You get a babysitter.
Niece comes over. My wife and I go to dinner. And I guess, like, I wasn't nice at dinner. And, like, to the waitress, I was like.
And you're saying that you guess because you don't even remember? Okay.
I can remember, like, seeing like the waitress and my wife being like this, and like my wife gets up to go to the bathroom, and I have, oh look, I have a full bottle of Trazodone down the hatch.
And is that your last? So there's some gaps in your thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
Like you barely remember getting there.
I don't remember a lot.
Do you remember what you ordered that night to eat?
I told my, I thought my, we were at a different restaurant than what my wife tells me where we were.
Oh shit.
Like, so I think that, like, we're at one place, and she's like, no, like, we didn't go there.
So how many pills are in this bottle?
30.
Have you ever heard of anyone using Trazodone to kill themselves before?
Never.
Didn't even do any research? This is just a... So this
I'm
is...
an addict. Like, it was... That was... Like, Oxycontin made me high.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like, I think it's escitalopram is an anxiety thing. So it's not... To me, that's not it. But, like, Trazodone, what it does... In my mind, I'm thinking if I take a lot of them, I'm going to go to sleep and I'm going to stay asleep.
Are you on any medication now?
No.
To this day? No. You're just on the CrossFit.
Congrats. I've taken none.
That's amazing.
I have not taken – I've taken allergy pill every once in a while because we live in the woods. But other than that, like even Tylenol, I don't have – like it's not.
So you crack the thing.
Mm-hmm.
At this point, you don't even care if you're hiding it. One of the impetus for this action is the thought that you had earlier in the day that you were going to have to come clean to this gym.
Yeah.
And you weren't ready.
Yep.
Did you ever think, this is going to fucking hurt my parents? Or what's my son going to think? Or
I never fully – I tried to stay away from that. Like that was my
– Like if that thought comes up, push it out and pop another pill?
Yep.
Okay.
Like quit thinking about hurting someone. Yeah. Like quit thinking about – what it's going to do to them. Like, my wife's going to be a widow, you know, at 30 years old. Like, don't think about that. Like, take another Trazodone.
It seems like you're just trying to deflect every negative thing
absolutely.
In your life by taking
Everything that came up negative, I deflected with drugs and alcohol.
I think it was my mom that said this. I shouldn't quote her wrong, but she recently said to me that her whole life she thought that people who killed themselves, that it was like the most selfish act. And only recently, and I'm sorry, Mom, if you didn't say this, if it was someone else, only recently she realized she doesn't feel that way anymore. It's a fucking sickness.
I used to say that people need help,
and that's a horrible thing, that horrible thought that she had, to think that they were being selfish. Because it's a fucking
absolutely
sickness.
A friend of mine, his uncle committed suicide when we were in high school, and we all thought, why would he do this? You know, why would he, like, that is so selfish. And it's like, he didn't want to be in that position. Like, nobody wants to do that.
No one wants to be a prostitute. No one wants to be a heroin addict. No one wants to kill themselves.
That's exactly
right?
Like Dan Tominski is a heroin addict. Dan didn't want to be in Darren didn't want to be a heroin. Dan wanted nothing to do with being a heroin addict. Like, I know that was not his choice.
I'm going to go off on a tangent here real quick. My wife used to work at a juvenile hall where they would take girls who were 15 years old for prostitution and put them in juvenile hall. It's like,
these fucking girls do not
want to fucking be prostitutes. Yeah. Why the fuck are you putting them in juvenile hall?
Absolutely. That's another one of those.
You're perpetuating the mess.
You're creating a problem by like, you're trying to solve a problem, but you're creating another problem.
Yeah. No one wants to be addicted to heroin.
Absolutely. Right. I never woke up and said, I want to be addicted to all these pills. I want to weigh 335 pounds. I want to have booze every day for the rest of my life as soon as I wake up.
You are responsible for it, but it's not what you want.
Absolutely. Like, I took those actions, but that's never was a goal. That was never my purpose.
You're sitting in the restaurant. The pills go down. By now, you're kind of a pro. You know, mm-hmm. to like to wash the liquid around the pills, and then you swallow all in one chunk? All at one time.
And actually, what I did was I put beer into the thing.
Oh, nice.
Into the pill bottle, because there's, you know, like a half inch gap.
Veteran mode.
So they went down in there.
Next level,
I knew,
for sure.
Yeah, I knew exactly how this was going to go down. And I was like, I remember putting some liquid in my mouth, and it.
Hey, that's some Hollywood shit. I've never seen that in a movie. We're now going to see that.
Question. Why?
Put the beer in fucking pill bottle.
Why just makes them softer.
It makes it
digest faster, or easier to go down?
Stick together as they go down if you take
it's
too many
one
pills.
One lump.
Huh. And once you get them wet, they slide, right?
Absolutely.
Can you confirm that?
Down the hatch.
Okay, just job checking. Thank
you. We'll test it later.
He looked. YouTube should have a special.
The only
that.
Drugs that Eric does come as gummy bears.
Those aren't terrible either. Those are not bad.
Haribo for life.
You're a 330 pound man. You're sitting in a chair at a restaurant. How many people are in the restaurant?
I don't know.
And
it's full. It's a Saturday night.
Are you the only person in the restaurant that is that overweight?
It's Iowa.
I would
Texas.
I don't. No, we're in Iowa. Oh, but I
dime a dozen 300 pounders.
I think like at this point there was no healthy estate initiative in Iowa. So yeah, there were some large folks in and around where I was sitting. Like they're like. You go to a restaurant, it's not a healthy. Drinking is what you do in the winter in Iowa.
Was it an all-you-can-eat restaurant?
No, I think it was.
But those are common in Iowa, right?
Very.
Way more than in California. They're hard to find here.
Yeah, very. There's as much as you can get for not a lot of money, not a lot of quality.
Matt, I've told you this before. I went to Lubbock, Texas, and didn't I tell you the story?
Yeah, I think
in the late 90s, and all it is like the most beautiful college people you've ever seen and people over 300 pounds.
Right.
And I was from California. I didn't see 300 pounders.
Yeah.
Only in the Guinness Book of World's Record.
Right.
I'm like, and everywhere you went was all you can eat. And I was like, what the
it's very, I just
fuck
had,
is going on?
I here? Had this conversation with Julie Weldon, Julie Spieler, drinking everywhere. Like the grocery stores, like you can say how healthy, like, oh, we're the healthiest state initiative next to 40 boxes of beer and a Pez dispenser display. Like, talk about riding the fence. Like, you know, shit or get off the pot. Which one is it?
Yeah. Right.
You know what I mean? Like, let's be real about what we're doing. If we want to be if Iowa is on this healthiest state initiative, like a cute bottle, you know, this huge Miller Lite display next to a Pez dispenser, next to like the health department. Like, which one are we going for? Like, it's another, like later, like. What are you showing kids?
No, right. I mean, at least it's light beer.
Right. I mean, it's like diet. It's like diet beer. You know, it's the diet version.
You're sitting there. The pills go down. She comes.
Lights out.
It is lights out.
Lights out.
How quick?
Instantly.
And so what does she tell you? Okay.
I wake up the next morning and she has no idea that I did it. Uh-huh. You know, she doesn't know that I'm this big of an addict. And, I wake up, obviously I'd thrown up everywhere. Mm.
So your body did kick the trazodone out.
Oh yeah. It was not welcome. It uh-huh. was like, and along with everything else that I had done that day, like it was not staying inside.
My God, I wonder if you barfed at the restaurant.
I think she would have told me. I don't think so. Like, I barfed a lot. Like, I know that I puked going into the house.
If we make the movie, you barf in the restaurant.
On somebody. Like, yeah. It's perfect.
Yeah, I mean, it's still in the same spirit.
Absolutely.
But it gives it that Hollywood.
It needs to be like a Stand By Me with a pie.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. What do they call it? Lard ass. Yeah, that. We'll do that. So I wake up to my two-year-old at about 11 o'clock. In the afternoon, my two-year-old saying, "Dad, Mom said I have to go."
11 o'clock at night.
In the morning. The next morning.
And you're in the
shaking
hospital?
My arm. No, I've puked. Like, in my house, on the side of my bed. Like, just puked. Like, there's shit and puke. Like, it was,
So you didn't go to the hospital?
My wife had no idea.
Oh, my God, dude. You're so fucking lucky.
Like, she was so
lucky you're alive.
Like, it's one of those things where it's like, I woke up and I'm like, oh, man, like, I don't know. She put my head to this side because I always lay on my stomach, and I always remember she put the pillow underneath me and would always try to lay me on my side in case I got sick that I wasn't going to choke on it. And my little guy was like, "Hey, Dad, Mom said we have to go. You know, Daddy, Mom said," and it wasn't Mom said I have to go. It was Mommy and I are going.
You're married to Mommy an angel, man.
Yeah.
You're really
married to a fucking angel.
And so I get up and I'm like, I rinse off real quick, and she's got a bag and she's like, "I got to go. Like, you were such a douche last night. Like, I'm done with this. You need to figure yourself out." So they get in the car with a suitcase.
Is your boy crying?
No, because he doesn't quite get it. You know what I mean? Like, he's not fully understanding.
Are you saying any shit like, "You can't take my son from me"? Or?
Not in a bad way. Like, I'm so sorry.
Right.
Okay. Like, please forgive me. And she's like, not this time. Like, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. And we've had that conversation so many times. And in my head, like, this was it. Like, I literally just, I woke up in a pile of my own stuff. Like, this, what did I do?
Right.
So I rinse off and I'm like, I clean everything up and I'm like, okay, what do I do? Where do I go? And I'm not going to tell my parents because they have no idea that I'm an addict. You know, I can't go tell my friends because then I'm just going to drink. Oh, there's CrossFit.
No shit.
That guy knows nothing about me. I can go somewhere where he doesn't know anything about me. And so I walk in there. Usually on Sundays, you know, when it's nice weather.
You walk in that day?
Yeah. Like that Sunday. Before open gym, I go to the parking lot.
And so at 11 a.m., your family leaves you, and later on that day, you
like
go
1 o'clock
gym.
That afternoon. Because open gym, I remember it being at like 2 o'clock, and he was the only one there. He was like, "Hey, what's up, Troy? You know, what's going on?" And I said, I need a change. And he's like, "All right, awesome. Come sit down." And we sat down, and like, he's like programming this like fucking paleo thing and like talking about paleo. This is what we can do to improve you. This is what I need from you. And this is what you can do for yourself. And these are the improvements that you'll see. And the way you're looking at me is the way I'm looking at him, like, really? Like, kind of in awe, like, holy shit.
It's like one of those spiritual or self-help books.
Yeah.
It's either now or never.
And that's what it was. It was now or never. And I'm like, okay, I'll give this guy a chance. You know, I realize that I'm an addict at this point, and I was like, okay, what's the worst that can happen? I can look better.
Have you had any therapy up until this point in your life?
Yes, all while I was on addiction. Tons of it.
So
okay.
It was irrelevant.
Tons of it.
So
lots.
And so the good news is you've really, all of these things from your youth to going to war all have been brought to the surface.
Here it is.
Okay.
Yep. It's all...
You're not. There's no denial at this point.
No.
Okay.
It's right here in front of me.
But you never really do. You ever have like a rock bottom? You see the light. The
rock bottom.
Bush?
I kept digging it. I kept digging. Like, everybody's rock bottom looks different. I kept digging it deeper.
Yeah.
There was no point where it was like, I get it. I'm in trouble. Like, I just kept digging deeper. I kept pushing the limits.
Like, even seeing your son taken away, you were still so high that it didn't like.
Didn't hit.
Okay.
It was not there. And so Reggie had said, you know,
that
hey,
I'm going to give your wife credit for leaving
yeah,
you.
She,
I'll give her the points.
Yeah.
She
and we had,
incredible.
That's,
we
had, the, that's the point.
Her and I just had this.
Until we find the real reason, I'm going to give it to her.
We, like, a couple days ago, we had talked about that. And it's like, wow, you it went like really, like we've talked about it a lot, but it was like, looking back, would you have stayed? And she still says she would have stayed.
Like she was going to come back.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
She was going to give me another chance.
Then she was going to bury you. Mm-hmm. You were going to die.
There was no doubt. And at when I was like, I'll just try this again. I'll do this another day. Like, it's fine.
Can you even believe sitting here talking to me that was you?
Not even, like, it's the guilt is there. It's there. But I've gotten past that in the last just over 2.5 years. Like, it makes me shake, like, thinking.
Is it all about your kids when you say the guilt?
No, it's my wife, too. Okay. Like, there's, you know, and especially, like, not telling my parents. Like, I had a support system. I just didn't open it up.
And they had you. You're their baby.
And that's, like, my mom has passed now. She passed in 2015, which was another shit that added on there, you know, into my addiction before I got sober and attempted to overdose. But my stepmom always calls me her baby, and she still, like, grabs my cheeks and, you know, like, gives me a big kiss. And, like, she – it's true love. You know, my dad really loves me, and it was like, why didn't I just tell him? Like, why – like, I trusted him. They could have helped me. They would have helped me.
Right.
So then I'm sitting there with Reggie, and he's like, yeah, we can do this. And you want to work out? I'm like, okay. Like, I guess. Like,
CrossFit.
He had just gone to regionals.
On drink some water.
The previous year. And work out. He's like, you want a salad?
Yeah.
It's like, so we work out, and I'm like, man, that was cool. Like, this guy can move. Like, that is neat. Like, what he can physically, how fast he can do it. Like, that's cool. And I'm like, fuck, that hurt. And he was like, I'll see you tomorrow morning. I'm like, yeah. So he had, you know, kind of made a paleo-ish spreadsheet, some goals. So I said, okay, we'll go to day two. I won't drink tomorrow.
Did in day one, did anything come up? Like, did you crack at all? Did you?
I had talked about that. I drink too much.
Okay. Okay.
I drink too much. But then day two was when it started. I spilled the beans.
Okay. Like, oh, wow. Some of them. He didn't have 3 hours.
Yeah. I spilled some of them. And
so there's like old. There's a lot of trust.
Very much right so. Now. Like, I figured, like, this guy owns a facility to better people's lives. Like, what can I do? What's up?
You know him?
Yeah.
Tommy Marquez getting ready to do Trolling the Leaderboard 18.4.
Ow. But it's like, I trust this guy. He's trying to better people. We'll go for day two, and then cool, day three, and then day four, and then a week, and I'm like, these people care, you know, and like people start saying, you know, so what's it like being, you know, not like what's it like being in Iraq, but it was like, I would, you know, if you encounter a veteran, you're going to know right away the guy or girl's a veteran. Like, they're going to tell you right fucking away. Like, they're very proud of it.
Rightfully so.
And it's like, so a friend of mine, like, we were running, and she was like, well, tell me a little more. And I just, and I'm crying, and she's crying, and we're running.
This is day two.
Like, it was the next week at some point.
Have you talked to your wife yet?
No. Oh, I talked. No, she was back at home, but we weren't talking.
Oh, okay. How many nights did she stay away?
I think it was just that first night.
And then she came back.
And then, yeah, but I was sleeping downstairs, and she was.
Okay. So you go the first day, and you're getting ready to go to your second class, and you're like, okay, I'm not going to drink tonight.
Yep.
And how about all the pills you have?
They were already gone. I'd taken them all. So I would take.
So you needed to re-up. So you
I needed,
not,
I
so
needed a VA refill. I'm like, I can get back. And I'm getting shakes at this point. I'm sick. I'm throwing up a lot.
Okay.
I'm profusely sweating all the time. Like, I'm miserable.
Okay. How long does that last?
About 2 days.
Okay.
Like, through the first workout, I'm okay. Like, then I don't know if I got sick.
Okay, sorry. So then after about a week of this, your wife is back at home. You've been basically going every single day for a week. You're eating better?
I'm eating much better.
How do you get through every day without drinking? Why don't you drink at night just a little bit?
So on day one, Reggie showed me Dan Tominski's, like, behind the scenes. Like, oh, this guy's an addict. Dan Tominski's sober date is my sober date. If that's not something that's meant to be, like, I can't tell you.
And did you know him before then?
I had no idea who he was.
Okay.
And then Reggie's like, hey, I know this. I see this veteran.
He's a fucking animal.
He is amazing.
Yeah, he's
that
an
dude
animal.
Can, like, and he, not only is he so great for, like, as an individual, but, like, for the veteran community, you can't pick a better role model. Personal athlete. his own physical fitness level, his gym as a business owner, what he does with that, like, that is, and I told him, like, dude,
he's intense.
Yes. He's a bad man. He's a badass dude.
Yeah.
And it's like,
look how geeky you look in that picture.
Yeah, we're talking about tacos there.
You look like you read in that picture.
Yeah, I can read.
Yeah, okay.
It was like, and that's Leah Cassiano. She does what's called mental kilter, and that was later on down the road, I was searching to better myself, and it's through fitness, bettering yourself, which she was, she used to compete in CrossFit, and now she does some powerlifting, and it's like combining those.
I'm sorry to hear that. She'll be back.
She tried the Wadapalooza.
She'll be back. I'm sorry.
She's fantastic. And so,
powerlifting is a sickness.
But she's good at it.
I know.
She's still, really, really good at it.
I'm just telling
you. And it's not terrible to watch.
People are moving. As long as they're moving.
I agree. But so is the marathon. It's a sickness. But it's okay. It's okay.
But so
it's on the spectrum.
They have a mental. This is at CrossFit Joaquin. It's mental kilter, and it's basically explaining how they've turned their addiction into fitness.
Okay.
And so it's like, this is cool, and like, I'm meeting Dan, and obviously, like, this is like. Like a bromance. Like, Dan's younger than me, but it's like, gosh, this guy, that's, at first I was like, I'm gonna aspire to be Dan, and then I realized how tough it is to do a couple workouts in a day.
Too hard.
Yeah, and it just doesn't make sense, you know, for me.
Me neither.
I'm not that good anymore.
So what is it that makes it so you're not gonna drink and pop pills?
Reggie tells me about Dan Tominski, and I was like, cool, if he can do it, if he can be sober, why the hell can't I?
So he knew he was planting a seed. Reggie wasn't stupid. Yeah, you came in, he's like, this guy's fucked up.
That's who he is. He didn't know how bad I was, but like, he knew that I was in trouble.
Okay.
And that is the reason he opened his affiliate, is to help people.
Wow.
So he got it. He put that seed in there. He planted that seed. And then so, like, I'm watching your videos, like, all your videos, like, behind the scenes, and I'm, like, geeking out about CrossFit, and I'm like, okay, cool, this is amazing. This is where I'm going to put my life. Like, this is what I'm going to do. And then, like, really fast, I realized that I'm not Dan Tominski pretty quickly. So the reality sets into me very quickly of, when I leave this workout, I feel so good about myself. The people in here care about me. And then I can better myself off of that. If this 40-minute effort, to where all of that negativity is gone, and there's such an positive environment inside of this, I want more.
So you weigh 300 pounds, you show up on the first day,
and within a
cold turkey, you fucking get off of everything and just start dropping.
Dan went cold turkey, and I saw Dan say that he went cold turkey on his, and I said, well, Dan, I can go cold turkey too.
How long before your wife starts talking to you again, and how long before you guys are in the same gym class?
I think within a week, we're both at like the 9:15 a.m. class, because she works from home.
Okay.
And I was a stay-at-home dad, but she was doing both.
And did she talk to you in that class that day?
Like, it was, at that point, we were back to, let's see where this goes. She still didn't trust, you know, that I was there yet.
Right. And you hadn't told her about your addictions yet?
No. You know?
She still didn't know you OD'd on the trazodone?
No.
Holy
shit. It wasn't until, I think, my 1 year of sobriety, which was 2016, that I had told, like, no one knew that I was going sober. Like, it wasn't my, like, I wasn't going to speak about sobriety until I got to this point. Like, I wasn't going to be 3 months sober and then fail. I wasn't going to, like, do CrossFit and then fail and not eat. So I did, like, the sobriety, the eating paleo, like, perfect for a year. And
you dropped another 70 pounds.
I was down to 212. So Dan's
90 pounds.
Dan's wife, Ricky, eventually she got in. She was my nutrition and, like, rock started, and it was like,
isn't Dan in the Northeast?
Dan is in the Northeast. Okay. Dan,
which is not near Iowa, just so people know.
No, it is in Long Island. Okay. Dan is owns CrossFit Lindy in Long Island.
Okay. And that's right.
And Dan is gonna make it to regionals this year, but Dan is going to decline. I saw yesterday on Instagram.
He should go to see me because I'm gonna be in the East filming.
I agree. Dan is a badass, but Dan is I think on his Instagram he said he's in the best shape of his life, but he didn't, like, Dan enjoyed this year a lot.
How old is he?
I think Dan is, he's younger than 34, and I think he just turned 30. And Dan and his wife are going on vacation during, like, a week after regionals, I think, or something like that. Yeah, so here it is. Look at that. Look at those tight pants on that guy. Look at that. Not everybody can do that.
He's all ass. He's a one trick pony. Okay, so So you go a whole year.
And then I start to tell people that I'm sober.
Do you tell your wife first?
Yeah. Yeah, so we like, I got involved in church. I got baptized, and then things just started. Like, I started to progress. I started surrounding myself with people that wanted to better me. Adam Wright, who owns another affiliate nearby, him and his wife embraced my struggle. Brent and Carrie Mentor, they embraced my struggle. Reggie and his wife. People started to open their arms to me. And as I would speak about my struggles, they would be like, yeah, you know, I take Ambien and drink wine before I go to bed. You know, I want to get better. I'm like, well, let's get better together. You know, I'll see you at CrossFit tomorrow. Let's do this together. This sucks. So then we had a mental kilter thing this past September. And it was like there's 55 members in my gym, and it was everybody had something. You know, there's everybody in that. All 55 of those people came for something. There was a – it
big,
may not be
– big degrees of shit?
Absolutely. It may not be PTSD and attempted overdose. Maybe it is self-confidence or certain things, but it was all being recognized in this gym, and look what we can do now. Look how we can fix it once you recognize it and speak about it. As soon as I started opening up my mouth, like, people came out of the woodwork.
In that first year, what was the hardest thing?
Admitting to my, like, right before 1 year, I admitted to my wife that I was an addict.
And that was hard.
It was tough.
Broke down crying.
Oh, yeah.
It was lost. It wasn't lost relieving it at all?
Saying the words, I'm an addict. I was an addict. This is what I was doing. And it was, I was crying because it was not on me anymore. Like, it was out. Like, here it is. Like, I'm so happy. Like, this is out of me. Like, these are my faults. Here they are. Like, they're no longer just stuck inside of me. I don't have to take all of this on anymore. I'm a good guy. These are the things that I sucked at. This is what I was terrible with. Here they are.
And she's CrossFitting to this day.
Mm-hmm. She's taking some time off right now. They're trying to figure out. She was in a car accident like when we were 18. And we took the money instead of the physical therapy. So they're figuring out. She's being able to get back like in through.
Tell her to work CrossFit. Out around yep. her injuries, man. Yep.
And that's.
Worst thing I've
and that's
ever
what
do is stop.
Her she mind changed. She was like, put a hold on my membership. And they, like, so she put a hold on her. We put a hold on her membership.
Kiss of death.
And the coaches then contacted her and were like, well, we have this CrossFit sweat class at night where it's maybe if you don't want to do, you know, the
weightlifting.
Yes, portion work of out it. Around the injury, man.
And there's it's, like, expanded into this large group of, like, 15 people at night. And she's like, well, I don't want to do that. I'm like, well, you don't want to admit that you're struggling. Like, what's she has some issues. Like, her dad has a glioblastoma, a brain tumor, and she's holding that all in, you know? And so it's like, I can't fix everything, and I try to.
Right.
And then, like, I try to fix everybody else's problems. And so, I mean, CrossFit is what is her sanity. Like, that is her gym. Those are her people. These are our people. Like, that's.
Any chance you'll ever go back?
Never.
Never.
And I told my wife this, like, she was like, well, you can never say never. I'm like, I'm saying never. Like, never, ever will I go back to that lifestyle.
What is the strongest thing? Why do you say that? What do you have? What do you have? That...
Empowerment. Self-awareness. Like, my coach, one of my coaches, Ryan, he's like a level 4 guru. But when he says certain things, like with my snatch, I'm super impatient. I try to, like, rip it off the ground. And he's like,
we all are.
Slow down. Think about what you're doing. Give yourself a break. So when he says this, I'm like, oh, yeah, he's fixing my – oh, I can use this in my personal life. I can take that home with me.
Have you taken your L1?
Give myself a break. No, like, a lot of people say that. Like, a lot of people ask, and it's coming. Like, I get it now. Like, CrossFit more to me means more than I can ever give back to it. So, like, getting as many people a chance in that opportunity.
Definitely a cult.
Yes.
With that kind of
somebody said the other day.
With that kind of talk.
We have arrived.
I made a comment. Somebody said the other day, they're like, CrossFit has a headquarters. And I'm like, yep, so did David Koresh. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like,
did you notice this building just floats?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like drove past it and I was like, how do I get up there? I'm like reaching for it.
Sits on a cloud.
Right. But it's like the reality. Like, I'll scale the shit out of anything. Like, it does not bother me. The reality of, and I put myself with Elijah.
Me too.
And I'll scale everything, and he will never tell me that he's better than me. And that's why I love him. He'll never, like, he will scale and be like, how about, okay, so this is what I have. How about you do pike push-ups? Pike handstand push-ups, you know what I mean? And a 95-pound barbell or no weight on it, you know? And it's like, instead of doing 8 burpees in this EMOM or 15 burpees, whatever crazy number he does, do like 7 and 4 sit-ups. You know what I mean? So he's scaling with him. I'm like, damn, I can give myself a break and do this in my own personal life. Like, I can slow down and, like, work at getting better. I can take these things home with me. And, like, if I'm not leaving, that's Ryan. He's a great, look at that beautiful guy back there.
You guys are all three shades of white to black.
Yeah, yeah, it's that's the Black Panther.
Man,
back
you,
there.
That's like the 8th picture I've seen with your shirt off. You do love
I don't,
shedding
like,
it.
I really like
I
it that
really,
you call him Elijah Muhammad.
Like, I really like it is like I
Game
think
on.
There's a difference.
It is hot
between,
in here.
I'm sweating.
I have a wool vest
it's
on.
It's getting a little warm.
Like, but I think like if you like I can show my flaws. Of being my weight, like I'm okay with that. I'm okay with being a little husky. Like, I know I want to get better. I know that, like, peanut butter is my problem. You know what I mean? Like, it's my vice.
If that's your problem,
you know what? Absolutely. And right. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, Jason Kleba put something up the other day and about a guy direct messaged him and said, "Oh, my handstand pushups this." And he's like, "If that's your problem, dude, life's awesome." Mm. And that's how I truly feel. Like, if my CrossFit workout. If I feel good about it, reality, honestly tell myself the effort that I'm putting in, if these are the results I'm getting, awesome.
Yep.
I am, and I always tell people.
How old are you again? 35?
I'll be 35 in April, next month.
Crazy.
And
you're so wise already.
If I can take this, you know, 20 to maybe 30-minute workout or a 7-minute workout, and I can give it my effort and the reality, like, good job. Awesome. Great job. Like, you put in, that was all you could give, which my effort is my effort. I'm not basing my effort. And that's why I listen to Pat Sherwood a lot. Like, that, I put myself near his Instagram because of that. You know, like, I get what he's saying. He's like, oh, scale this. No big deal.
Right.
Like, you're damn right. Like, that's awesome. Like, that is a positive message that other people need to get. And I think people get this idea of CrossFit that it's Elijah Muhammad or nothing. And he doesn't want that.
Right.
Like, he wants you to be the best you that you can be.
Right.
Because to get to him, it didn't happen overnight.
Right.
Dan Tominski overnight did not become a physical specimen.
Right.
You know, like, that's a lot of work, but, like,
there's this great line that I've used, especially to women. They're like, oh, I don't want to get that buff. And my response to them is like, hey, you don't have the work ethic.
Trust me, you're not working that hard.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's like, something like,
don't worry about that. Like that requires
like
some fucking work.
I was hoping we would all go shirtless for a little bit, but this guy won't take his vest off.
And I don't take my vest off. I can take my shirt off underneath it.
So, like, Brianna Siegert, she's Kyle Casper Bauer's little I don't want to call it understudy, but she's a phenomenal teacher at CrossFit Kinesis, and she's done some nutrition stuff. And
love
out
Kyle
a lot.
Casper Bauer, by the way. You
amazing.
Know him? You know
I don't know him big personally. Guy. I know Brianna.
Animal. Man, he
oh,
is
he's
a
we're the same
freak.
Age.
Freak.
We're the
he's
same
a
age.
Freak.
Like, he, like, his, like, he's using his physical ability. To max, like, he's maximizing his physical fitness. Like, he is doing what he, the most he possibly can be. Like, he's.
I would just
phenomenal.
Like to line people up and let Kyle run full speed into them.
Yeah, that would
he's
be fun.
A fucking cannonball.
He's a beast.
Yeah,
yeah.
He
like,
is
he's
a beast.
Yeah, like, and that's another one. Like, if you, if you, like, look at Kyle Cashman, we're like, wow, how many people he could take out. Like, if you roll him down a hill.
Yeah.
Like,
yes,
a bowling. Like,
yes.
In bowling.
That's
like,
exactly
how many
how I
people
see
can
him.
That
yeah.
guy, can
he
take
he
out?
He could probably jump to a 24-inch box with a U on his back.
Yeah. But people are like, well, I don't, I've heard girls say, well, I don't want to get that buff. And I'm like, trust me, you're not getting Brianna Siegert buff.
Yeah,
you are not going to be as buff as these gals.
And not only that, if you do, that's your DNA, man. Mm-hmm.
That's
fucking
genetics.
Accept it.
That is genetics.
Yes,
that is fantastic.
It. And for people
genetics.
Who don't, go fuck themselves.
Yeah, like, I think Cara Webb puts it a lot, like, about her thighs and how she used to struggle with it in the stories you do with her. And now she's like, I am like maximizing my physical potential, and she's going to have big thighs. Like, embrace the hell. Look how fantastic
and
she is.
And the more she embraces it, the hotter she gets.
Absolutely.
Like, her personality
the more,
is like,
yep,
yeah, you're like,
the
man.
More,
beautiful.
Like, the more she talks
beautiful.
About it. Like, another one. Carly Fur, she's a games athlete. I don't want to mess her name up. But she just said, like, she had some injuries and she wants to better herself. Like, she's going to continue to teach CrossFit and she's going to better her life through CrossFit. But she wants to go to school and stuff. But she's like, I'm going to come back for more. Like, I'm going to be a games athlete again. I'm going to be a badass. And it's like that motivation and that reality, like, everybody deserves that opportunity. Everybody deserves that chance. So what can we do as community? And I think my community is developing a fantastic solution and avenue for many people to use. And if you want to use it, fantastic.
I'd like to have you back with Reggie.
Anytime.
We told a pretty good story, I think, from birth to your first year of CrossFit. Yeah. Have you guys back? Talk to him about what it takes to run an affiliate. What it takes to have a client like you.
Yeah.
Is it harder? Is it easier? Is it more rewarding? Mm.
Because he's also like the nonprofit that he has helped me develop, you know, and that's giving back to more people. I mean, he's phenomenal.
In the beginning of the podcast, we talked about your childhood and about your encounter with this older boy who sexually abused you. Mm-hmm. Had you ever shared that before?
Not in this setting.
Just to your wife?
My wife, I don't think I did there.
Is that the hardest of all the things we talked about to talk about?
It's the hardest to admit.
Yeah.
For sure. It's the judgment, like you said, has anybody been like, oh, fuck, you're weird, like, you know, like, excuse my language, but it's like, man, what are you going to do? You know, like, I don't want to be perceived as that, but at the same time, worrying about what other people are, how they're going to judge me, I don't have time for that anymore. Because what if something, you know, God forbid something happens even on the way leaving here.
Right.
Like, now,
right.
Like people are getting... Hey,
you're not gonna. You're not avoiding. Like we talked about at one point, it's kind of a relationship to this. You're not avoiding heartbreak anymore.
Yeah, I'm done.
You're living your life
one day at a time. I'm going to make the best out of every single day. And if it admits that this taboo subject, well, cool. It's not. I'm not gonna let it be taboo anymore.
Would you ever consider going to AA?
I don't see it as that it doesn't work. We have a member at my gym who does, and it works phenomenally.
Yeah, of course it works.
You know,
I'm just wondering, like, is the last question I'm going to ask you. I know I asked you once already, but what's to stop you from going back now?
Self-love. I love myself.
You can't lose that?
Never.
Never.
I will never. I don't care how, like, what it takes, what it took for me to get, like, my self-love back. And that, getting to that spot, I'm never going to lose this.
Man, you are incredible.
I'm never, the self-awareness that I've that I've achieved and that true self-love, like, I'm not going to lose it, but I want to give everybody else that opportunity. And by speaking about it, like, here's your start. I know fantastic people who are willing to help you. You just give yourself a break. Give yourself a chance.
Do you want to give out your email?
Absolutely.
What is your email?
It's troy1cav@gmail.com.
If you made it to the end of the podcast, you probably should email him.
And it's trophyhusband, trophy.husband on Instagram.
Yeah. I think the only person that may be more incredible than you is Tiff.
Yeah.
Your wife.
She
bared the cross, right?
Yeah.
Did I use that right? I'm not even a religious guy.
I think it works.
I think, we're going to go with it. I think, yeah, she doesn't get, like, she doesn't like to take it, but then, like, it's hard
she
for
took
her
it twice.
To understand. That was it. No, I'm just kidding. It was, like, for her to understand what she has done, like, she doesn't like to be put in the light. So, like, a lot of times, like, we've just had a discussion, like, she's not – a lot of on my Instagram.
Yeah, she's pretty low pro.
She doesn't take. She doesn't take compliments well. As a you know a personal issue, she takes everybody else's problems on like she did with mine. You know what I mean? So like she doesn't all the time feel adequate. So and
a lot of people don't. No one wants. It's hard taking
veteran
compliments.
Spouses. Yeah. Like, don't like you're not the veteran. Don't worry about me. You know, like my husband's a hero, or my wife's the veteran. She's the hero, or the active duty, or whatever it is. Or, you know, my husband's the CrossFit media director, and he's so fancy. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's
I hear Haley daily say that.
I don't even think she knows. I haven't admitted it to her yet.
Thank you for your service.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I want to say thank you for your service too.
Absolutely.
And Eric.
Eric wants to thank you for your service.
Eric showed me around.
Yeah,
I would love to be a fly on the wall to hear his tour.
It was cool. It was fantastic.
It was okay.
It's like Vanna White, a lot of.
Awesome.
Wait, hey, Simon, let's land the C-130. God, I had a good one lined up, too. God.
Take two.
We could talk to you forever.
Yeah, I could talk forever.
We got to have you and Reggie back.